round three of the Gathering of Tweakers Endurance Series here live on iRacing Live in association with RaceSpot TV. And it is the 3 hours of Watkins Glen and what's sure to be an exciting race in this Gathering of Tweakers Endurance Series. Hello, my name is Paul Smith. Alongside me is Alvin Nieves with Hugo Louis on the cameras, and we're just finishing qualifying at the moment, so we'll just quickly run through the standings as they are at the moment. And currently on pole position, it is Blackadder Motorsports with the 166 car with a 1 minute 40.4 seconds time. Corsim Racing, they're close behind in second place. Team Heusinkveld Engineering, the current championship leaders in the top class, they are in third place with Avid Chronic Racing in fourth place. And in fifth place in class is Legends Racing, with Sim Racing for Holland in sixth. And show you the rest of your standings are on your screen at the moment for the prototype class. And then down in the GT3 class with the BMWs, it's Corsim Racing on pole position for them, with NAB Racing in second place. Madcape Racing, they are in third place. Fourth place going to High Octane Motorsports. Fifth place is Blackadder Motorsports with six, and Madcape Racing with their number 274 car. And there's the rest of your standings as they are at the moment in GT3. And then finally, we're down to the GTC class, the Porsches, and it is Baguette Racing, once again, the series leaders. They are on pole position for them, with Spirit of Le Mans in second place. Corsim Racing, they're in third place, with Talk Freak Racing in fourth. The Orange Devils, they're in fifth place, and DRS Racing in sixth place, with the last few of those teams there on screen. And Alvin, bring you into the commentary. It's the 3 hours of Watkins Glen. Watkins Glen, a classic racetrack for endurance racing, and we should see some fantastic racing here.
Yeah. Good morning, good evening, and good afternoon to everybody watching the race today. Yeah, this is another classic track for endurance racing. It's one of those races that, unlike many of the tracks that we may see later during the season, this is a very... The flow of the track is really fast. There's no really slow corners at all, so we'll be interested to see how each class interact with each other as they go along the race.
Now, of course, we are using the boot version of Watkins Glen, so you've got the classic section of the first part of the lap, and then they go down the chute and into the toe and through the boot of the track into the heel, and then back on to the classic shorter track here. As you say, it's a good challenge for these drivers. You've got to be careful for them for the race there. But strategy, that's going to be important as well. And just looking at this, you know, we usually see the pit stops on the hour, so do you think that they'll be running for two stops at the moment?
Yeah, I really don't see any change in strategy regarding how many times they're going to pit, so it looks like they should be going to the hour, most of the teams. I don't really know the figures regarding each car, how long they can go, but judging by what we've seen in previous rounds, it should be okay to go one whole hour in terms of fuel.
I'm just looking at the standings here. So in the prototype class, you have Team Heusinkveld Engineering. They're on 100 points. In second place, it's Corsim Racing, the 111 car. They are on 61 points, so a 39-point gap there. So Corsim Racing, they'll be wanting a good result here. They are starting in second, but Team Heusinkveld Engineering are right behind them.
Yes, now is the time that most teams are thinking now way ahead in terms of the championship standings, since we've only raced in two rounds so far. But even though there's still a long ways to go through the season, now it's the time for most teams to start figuring out how they will start going in terms of the championship standings. So that's another thing that we will be looking at, how each team will be approaching the race in terms of the balance of being aggressive and picking championship points as well.
In GT3, it's a lot closer. There's only 3 points between NAB Racing and Racing Lions. Racing Lions, they're really down the back end of the grid, though, in this race, so they're going to be struggling. NAB in second place in their class. And just quickly into GTC, as we were saying, Baguette Racing have won both the first two rounds. Spirit Le Mans on 74 points, 100 points, 74 points, so that's, 30... Oh, no, that's maths. 36 points between the two there, so a bit of a big gap there. So GT3 is where the championship battle is alive at the moment. I just want to just quickly mention, big thanks to Anwern Designs for the graphics, and also for Isfan Balor for the cameras. And don't forget that you can follow all of this race with us live here, but we can also have a look on the live timing as well, which is at timing.racespot.tv. So make sure you keep abreast of everything that's going on at the moment with, as you can see at the moment, Claudio Clima on the screen. He's intense, ready for this race to get going. Just waiting for the last few cars to come onto the grid now, and then we will be away on the pace lap. And this pace lap, it's going to be important to get your tyres warm and up to temperature so that you're able to just get up to speed straight away.
Yes, one good thing, not all the tracks here in iRacing have a full lap of full pace lap, and Watkins Glen is, it's one of those tracks that they got a full pace lap, so everybody will be really taking advantage of the fact that they got a full lap and making sure that the tires are up to temperature and making sure that they got all the communications and pit strategies nailed down before the start of the race.
Oh well, we're underway in fact, because it is a standing start by the looks of things. So we're underway in this race, and straight away we have Blackadder Sponsor in second place. Of course, Sim Racing in the lead at the moment of the prototypes. Behind, you've got the GT3s. Course Sim Racing has made the jump there in the GT3s from the start. We weren't expecting this, to be honest, but the GTC class, they're all running together, so I'm wondering if they're just holding back a little bit to get through the start. And in fact, we're going to get the safety car, because obviously something has gone awry there with the fact that they started with a standing start when it should have been a rolling start that we expected.
I was trying to get ready to get a good talk through the pace lab regarding other things that we can always talk about, but yeah, that this kind of caught us by surprise. But good job by the race control by catching it and throwing the yellow flag to get things under control.
Yeah, well, I think it caught lots of us out, so you me included. But yeah, they've thrown the safety car, so we will get three laps of safety car action just while we sort this out and get everything prepared and ready for the start, the proper start of this race.
Yeah, at least they will have a little bit more time to catch their breath now, and like I was saying, now they will have some time to make sure that everything is sorted out, teams and race control. It's kind of caught us by surprise, but yeah, now everybody will have some time to discuss a pit strategy and how things will go throughout the race.
Well, anyway, we're now under caution. The safety car has picked them up, and well, we could tell you, in fact, that the live timing, I could tell you, I do apologise, I said it incorrectly, it's the livetiming.nicktheason.nl. You'll be able to have a look on there for all the live timing of this race. And well, we're now behind the safety car, everybody just trying to organise themselves and get everything in order. And well, this actually could throw a little spanner in the works here. It could mean that drivers go a little bit longer on this first fuel stint, and fuel calculations will be a little bit up in the air now.
Yeah, if there was any doubts of any of the teams making it to the hour in terms of fuel strategy, now with this full course caution, I think everybody should be able to do this race on a two-stopper as well.
So yeah, so they're just going down the back straight now. with the core sim racing car as the GT3, so they're all caught up now. The GTC class, they're all at the back of this GT3 class as well. So just going into the boot are the prototypes, and there'll be a little bit of organizing going on now and just trying to find out how we're going to start this. But we are going to be a single file restart by the looks of things, so no side by side down the pit straight. So that means the field will be quite spread out for the start of this race.
Yes, now they're pretty much by now every team is now calmed down, and they are just now relaxing and getting more into how they're gonna run the rest of the race. Pretty much now it's gonna be getting all back into control, and once the next two laps are done, they're pretty much going back into green racing, and we will see how things go from there.
Yeah, so the safety car lights, they're still on at the moment. Just we're gonna get another lap behind the safety car. As we say, everybody just catching up to the back of the train now. And in fact, Claudio Clima in the GT3s in the Corse Sim Racing car, he's just holding everyone back at the moment in his group, just to basically just give them that little bit of a gap which they usually run at the start of the races, because of course in this series you do have about a 5 second gap at the start between each of the classes, just in case there's any instance down at the first corner, just to let that clear up before the next group come through. So Claudio doing a good job just holding everyone back at the moment.
Yeah, pretty much everybody now giving their own space. They should pretty much be getting ready to start the race. The next lap should be green flag racing, so now we will start seeing all the classes getting into position, and we will be going green flag soon.
Alvin, just from a sort of driver's point of view, when something like this happens, you know, is it a case of, you know, it throws you and you get it confuses you and it just makes you a little bit, you know, because normally you know the process, you know the procedure, and you've got everything planned and in your mind. So when something like this happens, can it just sort of throw a spanner in the works and just make it a little bit more difficult for the driver?
It can, because when you get into a race, you get into a mindset, you know. And so I guess every team, we're going into the mindset that we're going to have a full pace lap, so they were not expecting to get into a standing start. So yeah, it can kind of throw your mind off just a little bit. So it's also very important when this happens, trying to gather yourself and get everything back in order so that it doesn't affect you throughout the rest of the race as well.
So just to keep everyone up to date, at the moment behind the safety car the lights are off at the moment, so we will be going racing this time by, and it is Corse Sim Racing, the 111 car, and that's leading the field round, with Team Heusinkveld Engineering in second, Blackadder Motorsports in third, with Avid Chronic Racing in fourth place. In the GT3 class, you've got Corse Sim Racing at the lead of that group, with NAB Racing in second, Mad Cape Racing in third, and Liberty Motorsports in fourth place there. And in the GTC class, you have Baguette Racing in first for them, with Spirit Le Mans in second, Corse Sim Racing in third, Talk Freak Racing in fourth. But we are going around now, just up to the heel of the boot around this track, and we're almost ready to go green. So Alvin, I didn't get the chance to ask you, since we didn't have the warm-up lap, who's your tip for today?
Yeah, now let's we're pretty much almost going back into racing, so now let's see how teams handled this restart, as they should be starting at any moment now.
So yeah, just getting ready to come into the penultimate corner, this left-hander, and then you've got the right-hander onto the pit straight. The safety car will just turn off to the right there, just after the final corner. That's where pit entry is, and the Corse Sim Racing driver, Frederik Rasmussen, will get his foot down. The safety car just peeling in now. We're going to go green. The green flag goes out and we are racing. So it's not quite 3 hours of Watkins Glen, but away we go. There's some cars slower through the field further back. But away we go and down the inside. We've got Blackadder Motorsports there up into first place at the moment. Christian Challoner into that first place there for them, and through the S as they go. Hopefully nobody will have an accident through here, because it is a place where things can happen, but everyone seems to get through. BMWs, they're just making the start as well, the GT3s, and it's Corsim Racing in the lead of them in second place. It looks like Madcape Racing maybe have come through. No, it's NAB Racing. Madcape are in third place with High Octane in fourth place at the moment, and also the GTC class, they're getting underway now, and it's Baguette Racing at the lead of them at the moment, with second place is Spirit of Le Mans, and Talk Freak Racing are in third for them. But everybody so far has been able to get through quite cleanly. No sort of major incidents going on so far.
Yeah, good start by every class so far. Everybody got a clean start, so now we're finally back into racing. So let's see how they all handle this rest of 2 hours and 50 minutes of Watkins Glen.
Absolutely. So just going into the heel of the boot, the prototypes already, and it's Blackadder Motorsports that lead for this one. Frederick Rasmussen in second place for Corsim Racing. Talks Team Hoisic Belt Engineering in third place at the moment. They're all pretty close together at the moment. Well, there's only 4.5 seconds between all of the prototypes at the moment. It's a relatively short lap here at Watkins Glen. You're only talking about 1:40 for these prototypes. So really, that's going to be close. Just further back, we've got DRS Racing. They're battling away with SRN Motorsports in the GTC class. They're going almost side by side. Yes, DRS having to go defensive at the moment, going into the heel of the boot. SRN Motorsports just hanging back at the moment, but not able to get past there. So SRN Motorsports down in that seventh place, RSRN, with DRS right in front of them.
Yeah, great racing so far by everybody. Looks like everybody will get the official first lap of the race on skate. One thing that this track has that the previous two tracks don't have is, given how fast it flows in a short lap, the first lap will be a huge factor here. So you shouldn't see any big gaps between classes. But it'll be interesting to see once the prototypes start catching the GTC field, how the field will spread because of lap traffic.
And in the GT3s, it's Corsim Racing. They're trying to make a break at the moment at the front of that field. But NAB Racing are under some intense pressure there from Madcape Racing, High Octane. And also on the back of them is Blackadder Motorsports, a 267 car. So those three are battling over second place at the moment in the GT3 class, all within a second of each other. And, well, coming down into the heel, this is one overtaking opportunity down into this heel of the boot, but not able to have a look down the inside. But really, for overtaking opportunities, Alvin, you're looking mainly at the first corner, or maybe down into down the chute and into the boot.
Yeah, pretty much in terms of overtaking, given how fast the corners are here, you don't really have many spots that you can overtake safely. So it'll be much turn one, shoot, and perhaps you may see some people going into the hill of the boot, but it'll be kind of tricky. But you can really overtake anywhere. It's just a matter of how confident you are and how much the car that you are side by side with trusts you as well.
And, well, you've got to remember that it's a long race. It's 3 hours, and you don't want to throw away your race so early on and have an incident. So really, it's all about looking after the car, even though you do want to make up those places. But still, going into that chicane down the back straight, NAB Racing holding on at the moment from Madcape Racing. But Madcape just looking for that opportunity, maybe just eyeing up Fabien Dion to see what they will do, where the best place for them to overtake is.
Yeah, that's one of those instances that it kind of depends what strategy you have. It's kind of like the tortoise and hare strategy. Some people may go really aggressive from the race start, and some may go conservative. I really, what I do see is, well, I pretty much, I can kind of predict that most of the teams that are pretty safe in the point standings will go with a more conservative strategy, trying to keep their lead. And some of the teams that may be a little bit back on in terms of the championship standings may kind of turn the aggressiveness a little bit just to get there and try to challenge for the championship at the end of the season as well.
Now, of course, this is the third round of a seven-round series, this enduring series. At the moment, we've been at Sebring for the opening round and at Circuit of the Americas last time out. So, you know, there's still plenty of time for people to make moves in the championship, but the further it goes on, the harder it gets to be able to make those places and challenge for the lead of your championship. But still, these three cars, although I say these three cars, they've actually, NAB and Madcape have actually just got a little bit ahead of High Octane Motorsports, the 220 car, so they're just dropping back a little bit in fourth place in class, but it's still really tight and close together in the slipstream there down the back straight. But with that chicane there, it doesn't give you as long a run in the draft as you would on the old track and just straight down into carousel.
Yeah, there's a bust up, or yeah, bust up chicane. Some people have different name for it. It kind of throws a little wrinkle into what will be a really fast racetrack, but it's also a challenge for drivers trying to go in top speed and then going heartbreak into it. It can throw many people off, so that's also one trouble spot that we may get to see later on the race, especially when you have the faster classes overtaking the slower classes. It will be interesting to see how everybody interacts regarding giving space for overtaking as well.
Darren Seal is under intense pressure here from Sim Racing forward Rudy DeWitt. He's making the move up ahead of them as well. You've got NKH Racing, Avid Chronic Racing. They're battling away into that bus stop chicane. All those cars just deciding just to stay behind one another for the time being. But there's some battles all over. It's with Clark going a little bit slowly there. It's the Blue Flag Racing prototype, the 155 car. They were just running a little bit slower through that bus stop chicane, but now back up and running, so maybe just cut across one of the curbs there. But racing all the way through this field at the moment, we're just trying our best to keep an eye on everything to make sure you see the best action on the track. And I would say NKH, they've got a good run out of the tour of the boat. They're able to stay ahead of the Avid Chronic Racing car at the moment.
Yeah, and as we were talking about overtaking on the bus stop, there was two of the prototype cars going side by side, and there wasn't enough space for the two of them, and one of them ended up going into the grass, but he saved the car and he was still able to keep racing. So good job by them in keeping the car and being able to keep racing as well.
So we've had a quarter of an hour of the race so far, and at the moment it's Blackadder Motorsports, the 166 car, that's in the lead by 1.2 seconds. Corsim Racing are second at the moment in the 111 car, with Team Hoisinkveld Engineering are in third with the 178 car, but they're in the middle of a sandwich there, because Friction Racing, they're right behind them as well, in fourth place at the moment. In the GT3s at the moment, you've got Corsim Racing with the 211 car. They're in the lead of that. NAB Racing, they're still in second place. In fact, they've closed up a little bit of that gap now to Corsim Racing and NAB, so they're trying to make a move slowly towards the lead of that class. Madcape Racing in third with High Octane Motorsports now. They've caught back up to the back of them, so they're in fourth place. And in the GTC class as well, Baguette Racing once again pulling away from everybody. They're already 2.6 seconds ahead of Spirit of Le Mans, who are in second place in class, with Talk Freak Racing in third, and the Orange Devils, the team that finished second last time out, they are in fourth place at the moment. But really, just looking through the field, the battle that's on track at the moment is in that GTC class, and it's Core Sim Racing and also the 383 car. Well, they've got all the prototypes coming through at this moment, and well, this is when the lap traffic becomes an issue for the prototypes and the leaders. And as we said, it's a short lap around here compared to the other races that we've had in this season so far, and you're going to get that lap traffic a lot quicker.
Yeah, there's really no... Now it's a time that as soon as you catch the lap traffic, now there's really no time to relax. So now everybody will be on their toes for the rest of the race, as they will have to overtaking slow traffic, and those that find themselves in battles will also have to keep their eyes on the rear view mirrors as well.
And the lead battle on the prototypes is absolutely neck and neck because of that that traffic, and it's Core Sim Racing that have taken the lead. Frederick Rasmussen is in the lead of this race ahead of Christian Challoner in that Blackadder Motorsports car. So as we said, the traffic taking effect there. And well, they're still coming up to the GTC cars, they're still coming through there, so still chance for Blackadder Motorsports to take that lead back.
Yeah, good job by Frederick Rasmussen by taking advantage of using the field to overtake the leaders. Now, once they run through the GTC class, they will have to run through the GT3 class, and those cars have more downforce compared to the GTC class. So it may be a matter of having to overpower them on the straightaways to be able to overtake them instead of underbraking.
And well, down into the first corner, we've got the lead three together because the lap traffic has meant that Team Heusinkveld Engineering, they're able to get onto the back of them, and Friction Racing are also catching up to them as well because of this traffic. But now Baguette Racing, that they're catching up to, they're going to catch them at a nice spot for the two leaders because they're down that back straight. And into the bus stop chicane, Core Sim Racing out in the lead. Well, I thought Blackadder Motorsports were going to have a look there, but Team Heusinkveld Engineering just get caught up behind there, behind the Baguette Racing car. So unfortunately for them, they've just dropped back a little bit, but this lap traffic, it'll ebb and flow, and sometimes it won't go in your favour, but other times it will.
Yeah, there was a clear example of when traffic kind of plays against you, but like you said, there will be some give and take throughout the whole race, so they should be patience is key now throughout the whole race, and there will be a point that eventually traffic will play in your favor and you will be able to gain some time. But this will be the story of the whole race. Just you will gain some, you will lose some, so patience is key.
NAB Racing in second place with Fabien de Jong in the GT3 class, with Madcap Racing, Timu Toika in third place. I really am sorry about that. These two, you can almost throw a blanket over these two. They're that close together in this GT3 battle for second place at the moment, and they're into the boot of the circuit now, and NAB just still holding on to that place. But I tell you what, Core Sim Racing, they're not able to pull away yet. They're still in this battle for the lead. So NAB hanging on to Core Sim Racing, but Madcap really put them under pressure at the moment.
Yeah, it's just a matter of how they use the slipstream here on this track. This track is pretty much a draft circuit for these for most of the classes here. So we just have to wait till the prototypes come in and starts disrupting the rhythm of the GP3s, and we will see if the top three will get a nice gap between each other, or they will be running next to each other.
Friction Racing with Dean Prescott. They've made the move on Team Heusink Belt Engineering, so they're up to third place now. Heusink Belt down to fourth place. Your championship leaders in the prototype class, but they won't be too worried at the moment. They will just want to get some, just a bit of running under the belt, just to get into the flow of this track and let everything calm down at the moment. But yeah, good work from Friction with Dean Prescott to move it up into third place in the prototypes.
Yeah, that looks like Team Heusink Belt Engineering, they're just taking it easy, knowing that they pretty much, in terms of championship standings, they got a solid lead, so they may be either playing a very conservative strategy and just letting the race go along, and perhaps later they will have the race come back to them.
Black Adam Motorsports now right under the rear wing of that Corsim Racing car for the lead of this race in the prototypes. He's going to look to the outside. Is Fredrik Rasmussen is going to the inside. He's protecting that inside line for the chicane and is able to take the racing line through the chicane. But Fredrik Rasmussen under intense pressure from Christian Challoner at the moment in the lead.
Yeah, he got a good run, but decided to let cooler heads prevail and kind of go single file through the bus stop instead of trying to risk a pass and perhaps taking themselves out of the race. So good work by them, and you will see this this run from turn one all the way to the bus stop. Most of the cars here will have, if you are close to the car in front of you, you may get a good run and perhaps get a pass through the bus stop. But like I said before, you gotta be really confident in sticking that pass if you're going side by side through the bus stop.
Just coming back on to the old circuit, onto the final two turns, just through this left hander and then the final right hander into the pit straight for another lap. We're almost at half an hour of this race run, and we are up to 13 laps, just going on to lap 14 in this race. And once again, Christian Challoner right up behind that Corsim Racing car, decided not to make the move down the inside, but staying behind at the moment, trying to get that draft through the S's here. So easy to make a mistake through the S's and lose so much time. And well, he's dropped back a little bit at the moment, so I don't think he's quite close enough to make that draft work, but we have seen it happen before here at Watkins Glen. Down the back straight now into the bus stop chicane. Not quite close enough to make a move for the lead at the moment, but this is an intense battle and it will just go on and on at the moment.
Yeah, that's pretty much there's nothing that pretty much he can do if he's too far away. But I guess he is pretty much keeping his place on the track and just playing along, perhaps using the draft to save fuel as well. Even though we had the full course yellow at the beginning of the race for the standing start, it really never hurts to save as much fuel as possible and see if you can use that fuel saving to your advantage later in the race as well.
Well, just still, it's really close between these two, and with these two battling away, they're actually bringing Friction Racing with Dean Prescott into this battle as well. He's been closing up to these two these last few laps, so that's going to make things interesting. Just further back in the GTC class, we have got the 383 car, the ABL Endurance team with Tony Hayes at the wheel. They are battling with the WR Racing car, the Martin Green at the wheel of that one, and behind them Blue Line Motorsports with Brian Loyster at the back of that group as well. These all three battling for the final few positions in the GTC class, but still an important run, as we've had an incident and it's the Mad Cape Racing car. They've had a little crash there. What's happened is going into the bus stop chicane.
Yeah, I'm trying to see what happened to them, and it looks like it could have been going side by side. Yep, indeed, they were going side by side into the bus stop, and I guess there wasn't room for both of them, and somebody has to pay the price. And unfortunately, not only Mad Cape Racing, but also the number
NAB 208, they've got a lot of damage there, haven't they? Because they went into the barrier on the right-hand side there pretty hard, did NAB Racing, so they'll have quite a bit of damage on that front right corner of the car, and this could cost them the race.
Yeah, it's really unfortunate for the NAB Racing car that crash that happens, but this is one of the parts of the endurance racing. You gotta decide where you wanna be aggressive from the start or you wanna be conservative, and unfortunately for them they got caught on the wrong side of the so yeah, really unfortunate, but it's still a long race to go, and they can always try to salvage some points.
Well, they're both still running, that's the important thing. Just at the front of the field, at the in the prototype lead, we've got a three-car train now. There's a three-car race for the lead of this race. It's Core Sim Racing with Frederik Rasmussen in the lead. Then you've got Black Adam Motorsports in second with Christian Challoner. In third place is Dean Prescott in that Friction Racing car. And on the back of them also, catching up to them, is Team Heusinkveld. So we're going to have a four-car race for the lead.
Yeah, Heusinkveld is just playing it safe, knowing that since pretty much they got a long race to go, and with draft playing a huge factor, they can just sit back, and in case something happens with the front three, they can just pretty much sit back and kind of maneuver their way along the top three. And speaking of maneuvering along traffic, looks like they're catching the GT3s as well. So, now things are gonna get more interesting.
Yeah, more interesting is right. As you say, they're catching up to the back end of this GT3 class. And as you were saying earlier, these GT3 cars, they have more downforce than the GTC class, so they're able to go around the corners faster. So it's not as easy for these prototypes to get past. And Friction Racing are finding that out the hard way, because now Heusinkveld Engineering are right up to the back of them. They had to get on the brakes there to avoid one of the BMWs there. And, well, they've managed to make it past that BMW's run wide onto the grass. But they've somehow managed to make it through, but Friction Racing losing out a lot of time there, almost 2 seconds.
Yeah, it's always kind of scary when you get when you encounter your first time around around a class, because kind of depends what happens with. It's kind of one of those things that you don't know what to expect at first on a track. Of course, by now round three, they should be having an idea of how cars interact with each other, and they should be a little bit more respect towards each class. And looks like so far we haven't had any problems in terms of overtakes between classes. So it's good to see that everybody has a cool head, and we're having really good racing so far.
Well, we have got a four-car train here in the GT3 class. You have Black Adam Motorsports with Marco Luca Abate at the lead of this in the 267 car. Euphoria Racing with Juan Segura in the Euphoria Racing white car. Hawk Racing with Mario Reich in the third of this battle. And at the back of this battle, Top Creek Racing with Stefan Coppens. And they are at the back of this group at the moment. But as we say, four cars, and they've got the prototype leaders catching up to them. And, well, these are all battling away. How difficult is that to go through lap traffic when they're all battling for position?
Well, it's really a difficult thing to do, because you are trying to, you know, respect the fact that even though they are separate classes and they may be slower, you gotta respect the fact that they are having their own battles, but also at the same time you have your own battle, and you gotta keep an eye in front of you and keep an eye on the rear mirror, and it's pretty much a matter of how much they trust each other. Sometimes they...
Oh, going three wide down the back straight, sorry there, Alvin. It's going neck and neck. These lap markers are really playing havoc with the leaders. They're going into that bus stop chicane, and somehow, amazingly, they're all able to get through it. I thought they were going to come together there, because they all got very close.
Yeah, this is a really, really entertaining battles that, and it's pretty much all three classes interacting with each other, and each of them are on their own battles, but it's really amazing to see the respect that each of them are giving to each other, and this is really what endurance racing is. It's all about close racing, respect from each one, and really fun and hard racing as well.
I could tell you that the leaders have all managed to get through that group there, that gaggle of cars, but it's still close racing at the moment at the front, because Course Sim Racing, they're just 1 second ahead of Blackadder Motorsports, who are in second place. Third place, it's Friction Motorsports. They're right on the tail of that Blackadder Motorsports car, with Team Heusinkveld also on the tail of them, just 2.1 seconds covering the first four drivers in this race. And as we say, we've got these battles all the way through the field. We've got the GT3s battling away. We've also got GTC cars there close together as well. So it's a question of where do we look, because there's just action all over the place. It's fantastic, Alvin.
Yeah, that's really what we are here for, watching good racing between each other. And just because this is sim racing doesn't mean it's we take it less serious as real life. You know, it's as fun as real life, but without the dangers of crashing and getting injured. So it's really good to see that everybody here is giving their 100% and into doing the best they can on the track.
ABL, oh, we've got a spinner at the back there. Who was that? It's one of the prototypes, I think. I'm just having a look here. It's the Hawksim Racing 124 car has had an incident going on to the main straight through the S's there, on the exit of the S's. I'm just trying to find out what happened. Oh, one of the other prototypes got caught in the barrier, and there was contact between two of the prototypes, and well, that was incredible. But at the front, it's still Corsim Racing, but now down to third place is Blackadder Motorsports, because Friction Racing, they've made it up to second place at the moment. Dean Prescott doing a fantastic job getting that car up to second.
Yeah, it was really unfortunate for the 124 that they were just minding their own business, and another prototype car just caught the wall, and they collected the 124, so it's really unfortunate to them, and they are in the pits, so we'll see what happened with them, and they're gonna
battle for the lead. Corsim Racing under intense pressure down the inside. Looks Dean Prescott into turn one and just not able to make that move stick. But Corsim Racing now really struggling to keep this lead at the moment. But Dean Prescott's under pressure now from Blackadder Motorsports. They want that second place back at the moment. But here we go, the draft down the straight, and Corsim Racing, they've been caught cold, because it's Friction Racing who take the lead with Dean Prescott. And well, Frederick Rasmussen having to slot in second place at the moment, with that Blackadder Motorsports car in third, and Heusinkveld, Team Heusinkveld Engineering, let's not forget them, they're close behind in fourth place. There is only 1.2 seconds covering these first four cars in this race. This is just fantastic. I love it. As down the inside of the Corsim Racing car goes Blackadder Motorsports' Christian Challoner, but he's got to go around the outside the next corner, decides to slot in behind the Corsim Racing car of Frederick Rasmussen. And Dean Prescott, well, he's trying to make a break for it while all this is going on.
Yeah, great job by Dean Prescott from the 199 of Friction Sim, Friction Racing, doing the overtaking the Corsim Sport car there. That's one example that even though they were behind, they were able to use the lap traffic to their advantage, and they pretty much set up that pass. So really good job by Dean Prescott to overtaking the Corsim Sport car.
Yeah, so at the front at the moment, it's Friction Racing with Dean Prescott, as we say, in first place. In second place, Corsim Racing with Frederick Rasmussen at the wheel. Blackadder Motorsports, though, they're looking busy. They're trying to go down the inside at the moment of Corsim Racing. Not able to make that move stick into turn one. But they are in third place of Blackadder Motorsports, with Team Heusinkveld Engineering in fourth place. Christian Kewitt in that car for them. And well, it's all go at the moment with this race. It's fantastic racing so far. We have had a couple of people being in the pits. The 191 car, AKH, they've actually been in the pits so far in this race for about 10 and a half seconds. So an early pit stop for them. And Christian Bug as well in the 124 car. They're in the pits. They've got a lot of damage on that car as well, so they're in the pits at the moment. But at the front, it's still Friction Racing, but they are under pressure from Core Sim Racing and Blackadder Motorsport.
Yeah, so far they got in through pretty much most of the lap traffic that they were going through now, so they should be able now to settle into a nice rhythm now till they catch the next batch of traffic, which should be. Yeah, next lap now, pretty much. Yeah, there's not gonna be any rest for any of the lead cars. They're pretty much gonna be catching traffic every single time now. So whenever they can get a chance, they should just relax and take it easy till they catch the next group of cars and go at it again.
Yeah, Dean Prescott now just pulled out a little bit of a gap. It's a 0.7 second. Of a gap between him and Fredrik Rasmussen in that second place in the Core Sim Racing car, and Blackadder Motorsports are right behind them in the 166 car in third place. At the moment in the GT3 class, you've got Top Freak Racing. They are right there with NAB Racing behind them. Madcape Racing is involved there as well. You've got the prototypes back passing them as well, with lapping them, and it's just all happening at the moment between these cars, because Top Freak Racing, they're trying to make their way through past the GTC class, the Core Sim Racing car of them. And well, at the moment it's Euphoria Racing that's at the lead of this battle, as Dean Prescott is having a few problems here. He's had a little bit of an incident. They were side by side through the bus stop chicane, and oh, Dean Prescott just getting caught by one of the GTC cars that they had gone past. But yeah, they were going side by side with Core Sim Racing for the lead down that back straight into that chicane, and well, they just ended up coming together and just losing the back end. And Dean Prescott now having to recover. He has fallen down to fifth place.
Yeah, it looks like they were going side, unlike the previous overtake that Dean Prescott did over the Core Sim Force car. They were able to complete the overtake before going into the bus stop. This one, though, it was side by side going into the bus stop, and unfortunately, they got caught on the wrong side of the wrong side, and they looks like they spun. They may have spun. On their own when they caught the inside curb, and also unfortunate that they got tagged by Baguette Racing. As a matter of fact, it looks like they were the cars that were involved with them in the incident going into the bus stop.
Well, Baguette Racing were lucky there, because they had such a gap that it didn't really affect them too much. They're still in the lead of that GTC battle. Just at the moment, the prototypes, Legends Racing and FRT Hawker 109 and the 142 car, they're battling away for sixth position at the moment, down the back straight, just going past the GTC class. Oh, there's a big incident there! Into each other they go, and that's going to cause quite a bit of damage to those cars with the aerodynamics and possibly some suspension damage as well. But the FRT Hawker car just going down the inside into that chicane and not able to make that move stick.
Yeah, just as I was praising how things, how the respect that everyone was paying to each other on the track, looks like everybody is starting to lose their cool just a little bit, and we just had two incidents in a span of two laps, and they've all involved prototype cars, unfortunately, and unlike the GT cars, these cars are just a little bit fragile, and they really don't like taking that much damage. And one thing that we also have here is we got a live race control, so it'll be interesting how they look at these incidents and if they determine that there was any avoidable contact and if there will be any penalties handed to any of the teams as well.
It just seems to be the nature of this track that because it's such a short track and because it's such a tight but flowing track, that unfortunately incidents like this are going to happen. As at the front in the prototypes, Core Sim Racing under pressure once again from Blackadder Motorsports. Core Sim Racing in the lead at the moment, but going into the chicane now, taking that inside line and just managing to keep that place at the moment. Frederik Rasmussen doing a really good job to keep the lead at the moment.
Yeah, and as a result of the incident that's been happening, we have many cars going into the pits now. At the 142 of the FRT Hawker into the pits, I guess it's to, they got pretty massive damage, so it's gonna really affect the race as well. Don't know the extent of the damage, but it could be a race over. Well, looks like they are back on the track as well, so never mind. They should be doing good, I guess.
Don't forget that you can get live timing online with livetiming.nicktheisen.nl, and that is where you can keep up to date with all of the action. Keep an eye on your favourite drivers and the pit stop times and everything like that that's associated with this race. At the moment we're about 45 minutes into this race. It's Core Sim Racing at the front at the moment, with Frederik Rasmussen in the triple car, Blackadder Motorsports in second place in the 166 car, with Team Heusig Belt Engineering now in third place in those prototype classes. In the GT3s you've got Core Sim Racing, the GT3 class of the 211 car, Claudio Klima at the front of that field at the moment, with High Octane Motorsports in the 220 car. They are in second place, with Mad Cape Racing in third in the 274 car. And in the GTC class, your leaders at the moment, it's Baguette Racing with that little bit of damage to the front of their car because of that incident with Dean Prescott. They are in the lead though, with second place Spirit of Le Mans, and in third place Talk Creek Racing, who have got the Orange Devils right behind them. Actually they're close together in those two, and that's a battle for third place in class.
Yeah, as of now, pretty much everybody is kind of trying to settle down after the many incidents that have been happening so far, and it looks like we're having some of the prototypes going into the pits now. I've been seeing some of the cars that are going into the pits. Don't know if it's because of damage or they are it's part of their pit strategy, but from the looks of it, it seems like it seems like it's pretty much damaged so far, damaged cars.
Yeah, absolutely. Just looking at the cars that are on pit road at the moment, we've got the Avid Chronic Racing car. They are on pit road at the moment. It just looks like they're having to fix some damage there. Behind them, Adam Kell in the V-Apex Racing team. They are on pit road as well in the 132 car, although they're just coming out of the pits now, so maybe a scheduled pit stop for Adam Kell. You've also got Christian Bug in the Hawk Sim Racing car. They are on pit road as well. And there's one of the GTC cars as well. They are on pit road as well. And in fact, is that the Spirit of Le Mans car that's on pit road there? I do believe it is, by the looks of things. So a real disaster for the 333 car. They are usually one of the front runners in that GTC class, and they're unfortunately on pit road. But at the front of that GTC class, you have a battle between Talk Creek Racing and the Orange Devils. This is for second in class, and the Orange Devils, they finished second last time out at the Circuits of the Americas, and they're battling away with Talk Creek Racing, and now it's a really good chance for them with Spirit of Le Mans in the pits at the moment to maybe make a move and get through. And there's a drive-through penalty for the 132 car, and that's Adam Kell in the V-Apex Racing Team car. So there's a drive-through penalty for pushing wide and contact is the decision, and that was on lap 19 on turn 7. So obviously the administrators having a look at that, the stewards making that decision, and it's our first penalty of the day. And that's the thing with having live stewards in these races. If something happens, then they can have a look at that and make a decision, can't they, Alan?
Yeah, that's one of the big difference between this league, NEO, and many other leagues, that they have they do have live race control, and it's good that they try to resolve these matters on the racetrack instead of waiting for the race to be done and then looking at all the incidents that happened and then trying to sort everything out. So yeah, it's always a good thing when you have these type of race control, so you can pretty much keep the whole race in order and don't let things get out of control as well.
Christian Challoner has made his pit stop, comes out the pits, 17.4 seconds for their pit stop. So obviously a scheduled stop now with about 49 minutes of the race gone so far. So it'll be interesting to see how long CoreSim Racing can go with the lead at the moment. Sim Racing for Holland, they're battling away at the moment with Friction Racing. Dean Prescott with a lot of damage on that left-hand side of his car. So he's having to battle on with that. But Sim Racing for Holland, they are in fourth place at the moment. Rudy De Wet, and he'll be trying to get that place back because he was ahead of them at the start of this lap.
Yeah, it's really unfortunate for the 199 Friction Racing car. They've been involved in pretty much incidents for the first three rounds. First one was kind of one of those that they didn't have any control of. Then they had some hardware failure with one of the drivers, and looks like they're going into the pits now. So looks maybe a scheduled pit stop because they didn't pit for damage earlier on. So we'll see how much damage they can get repaired, and if possible get some speed back. And also looks like there was a black flag assigned to the Francisco Gonzalez. Gotta look at what the car is, but they got a 30-second stop and go penalty.
Yeah, so obviously a serious offense there. FRT their team at fault, but yeah, Francisco Gonzalez with the penalty, the stop-go penalty there. And well, Dean Prescott on pit lane at the moment. It's a long pit stop, so obviously they're having to repair something on the car because they have been in the pits over 30 seconds so far, and still they're waiting to get that. So obviously enough damage on that car making them wait to get that car fixed, as there's another car coming onto pit road as well, one of the prototypes. So I'm just trying to find out who that is. That is Francisco Gonzalez in the FRT Hawker car, the 142 car, coming into pit light road at the moment to serve that penalty. Or are they just going to take the pit stop?
Well, they were handed a stop and go penalty, so they are definitely gonna. They do have to serve the penalty right now, and I guess after this, if I remember correctly, they may be allowed to also do their pit stop as well.
So Dean Prescott in the Friction Racing car is back out on road now. We've got a battle in the GTC class, and it's DRS Racing with Costa De Rida in that 389 car, with SRN Motorsports right up close behind them, behind that GT3 car that's about to lap the DRS car. And well, SRN Motorsports with Marty Jeffries doing another good job at the moment, just trying to make those places as the prototype goes past them as well. And you just see the speed difference between the different classes, and it's amazing, to be honest, that we haven't had more incidents.
Yeah, it's been pretty much been between the intra-class battles that we have the biggest incidents so far, highlighted by the two incidents on the prototype class by now. It's really mind-boggling how the speed difference, not only straight line but also in cornering, between the prototype cars and the GTCs. And one thing the prototypes must keep in mind is that the level of downforce, the difference between them, it's gonna really play a big factor in when they overtake, and also understanding that since the lack of downforce on the GTC class, once they commit to these fast corners, there's really no lifting for them. So they also do have to keep that in mind.
Oh, well, I could tell you that the Racing Lions car has just gone for a little bit of a slide through turn one, but up ahead of them, you've got Hawks in racing with the GT3 car, the 223 car with Mario Reich at the wheel, and behind them, Euphoria Racing White. They are battling it out. This is over fourth place in class at the moment in the GT3s, as that Hawks in racing car just runs a little bit wide there. And, well, just having to push really hard is that Hawk Team Racing car, and Euphoria Racing White with Juan Segarra really putting this car under pressure. He's going to look down the inside, possibly into the heel of the boat, but not able to make a move yet, but certainly letting them know that he is there behind them.
Yeah, so far so good for them, and it should be they should be close to doing their first pit stop, so now it's just a matter of trying to dial everything down to the next stop, trying to keep a clean car.
Is that in the wall? We had a GT3 car in the wall, but on the track, it's Kim Salveson of the High Octane Motorsports, the 220 car. He's gone into the wall, he's got a lot of damage and straight into the pit, and then he was in, I do believe he was in second place before that happened in class, or third place certainly, and what happened was just lost control, or put a wheel onto the grass on the exit of that penultimate corner, the 220 car spinning round, and that is a lot of damage on that BMW GT3 car, and they're going to be in the pits for quite a while now.
Yeah, turn 10, even though you can kind of run wide, since there is no wall to really stop you into trying to run a little bit wider, it's really one of those corners that you really got to be careful. If you decide to run a little bit wide, there's grass in there waiting for you, and once you touch it, there's really no going back, and pretty much you're going in for a ride. And it's really unfortunate for High Octane Motorsports what happened to them. So, it's one of those that you really gotta be careful what you do. It's pretty much risk versus reward. They took too much risk, and unfortunately they came up on the losing side.
And well, we've still got this battle between Hawks Sim Racing and Euphoria Racing White in the GT3 class. The 223 and the 222 car both together, really close between them, just half a second covering the two of them. And well, all of this battling is allowing NAB Racing to catch up, who of course were in second place in the GT3 class earlier on, until that incident earlier on in the race. But these two battling away for that fourth place, third place now, as it is because of that incident with the 220 car of the High Octane Motorsports. So third place in class, and that'd be a good result for these teams.
Yeah, it looks like as the pit stops start cycling now, everybody is now trying to take a little bit of a breather and getting ready to pit. And it'll be interesting to see how after the pit cycle is done, where everybody is heading in respect to their classes, and if they're still gonna be battling side by side, or perhaps still taking advantage of the draft and trying to keep things as close as possible as well.
Well, it's just four of the prototype class have yet to pit at the front of that group. As I could tell you, actually, Christian Challoner has just moved ahead, so an upper car into the pits in the prototypes. That's the 176 car Pros Racing Sport into the pits with David Taranzo at the wheel there, so they're making their pit stop now. But yeah, as you say, the prototypes, they're all pretty much done for their pit stops, just three of the prototypes left still to pit in this race. And of course the GT3s, they seem to go a little bit longer, as NAB now onto the back of this battle for that third place in GT3 class.
Yeah, and now we have another car coming into the pits, another one of the prototype cars coming into the pits. It's looked like it's the, let me check the number, There wasn't any car coming into the pit. I just had it on replay. Sorry about that.
Well, I can tell you, one of the GT3 cars is coming in. That's a Euphoria Racing white car, the 222. So that's now released NAB Racing to be able to possibly try and push and latch onto the back of that Hawk Sim Racing car. But of course, behind them, they have the Mad Cape car at the back of that group as well. They are behind Talk Freak Racing. So really, battles going on through this GT3 class at the moment down that back straight, and Talk Freak having to go defensive at the moment from Madcap Racing and able to hold on to the place going into the bus stop chicane for the time being.
Yeah, so far it's these cars are really given the huge big amount of downforce that they have, they really gotta keep themselves in check. They can really corner, they really got good cornering speed, but even though they lack straight line speed, they shouldn't be taken lightly. So it's good to see both of them trying to race as hard as they can, and they do have all the overall leaders. They are coming right to them, so it'll be, I don't know, they should be ready to come into the pits as well, so let's see what happens once they come to the start-finish line.
Christian Kiewit has been in the pits for Team Hoisigmal Engineering, a 25.7 second pit stop, so maybe just making a little bit of, fixing a little bit of damage there on their car, because we've generally been around to like the 18, 19 second mark for the prototype pit stops for the time being. But at the front, Course Sim Racing come in to the pits now. The 111 car, the leaders, Frederick Rasmussen, into the pits. So it'll be interesting to see where they come out now. This is the last of the prototype cars to make their first pit stop. And coming down the pit road they go. We've hit the 1 hour mark, so able to, with that safety car at the start of the race, just able to make their fuel last a little bit longer than normal. So it'll be interesting to see when the GT3s and the GTC class make their pit stop. But anyway, Frederick Rasmussen now in the pits, just waiting patiently for the fuel to go in and for the tyres to change, getting ready to come out again, and they'll be hoping that they'll come out in the lead. In fact, by the looks of things, Blackadder Motorsports have taken the lead with this one. They're in the lead with the 166 car, and Christian Challoner, fantastic job from him to take the lead of this race.
Yeah, pit cycles with the pit stops already done now, we do have now we're starting to have some changes in terms of positions, and it looks like the Blackadder Motorsports just got into the lead. So will they be able to keep the lead or not? We'll still got 2 hours to go.
Niklas Helm in the NKH entry on the 191 car. They are into second place now. So Core Sim Racing have moved down to third place in this race at the moment. And well, just having a look now through the field, they've all pretty much spread out now in that GT, in that prototype class, apart from the Core Sim Racing car behind the NKH entry.
Yeah, pretty much we got all the prototypes already into the pits. Now we're still waiting for the GT3s and GTCs to come into the pits, and yeah. Now it's just a matter of letting the pit cycle go through and see where everybody is now in terms of race positions and readjust strategies if needed to. But it looks like the Core Sim Sport just coming out of the pits, and now they're getting to battle for the lead again.
Well, Core Sim Sport, of course, they're in third place at the moment in this race. They're having to attack NKH. Now, NKH, they went a little bit short to start with. They fueled light to start with and made an early pit stop. So they're a little bit out of sequence. They are they're obviously running a different strategy, and we'll see if this one works out. But Course Sim Racing, Frederick Rasmussen is right up behind them now, under the gearbox, under the rear wing, trying to make that move, but not quite close enough when they go into the chicane. And Sim Racing for Holland in fourth place. They've just run a little bit wide through the chicane, and well, that's lost them any chance of getting onto the back of those two. Battling for second place, Core Sim Racing now with Frederik Rasmussen looking on the inside, going through the chute, and now down towards the toe of the boot part of this track. NKH though doing a good job to keep ahead.
Yeah, so far very good racing between both of them. Since for Holland, they really had a moment there, and they were able to save it, fortunately. So they can still keep with the race, but it was kind of a scary moment as well.
So go down the inside of one of the back markers, and then KH have just run a little bit wide through there. The next corner is left-hander, and Core Sim Racing with Frederik Rasmussen takes that second place back through that penultimate corner into the final corner now. And well, Frederik Rasmussen will be wanting to get the hammer down and be able to try and close up that gap to Blackadder Motorsports. Christian Challoner doing a fantastic job at the moment, 13.2 seconds ahead of second place Frederik Rasmussen.
Yeah, really a really nice job by the 199, by the Core Sim Racing car. They were able to use the traffic to their advantage, and they just were able to do the pass, and now we'll see if they can pick up the pace and catch the leaders as well.
Side by side through the chute were Talk Creek Racing and Madcape Racing, the 2F1 and the 272 car, and they're still battling hammer and tongs now towards the heel of the boat into that braking zone, not able to make that move. Stick and Stefan Koppens in the Talk Freak Racing car, just having to just drop back a little bit behind Madcape, and Madcape of course having to recover after that little incident with NAB Racing. NAB Racing, by the way, have been in the pits. They had a long pit stop for their car, so possibly fixing some damage. We have lost quite a few cars. Well, only two cars we've lost at the moment. We've lost Spirit of Le Mans. At the moment, they're not running at all. And also the 220 car of Joachim Svensson, they appear to be out of this race, as well as Martin Green as well in the 317 car. They're switching drivers at the moment. They're in the pit stop. So the GTC cars are pretty much doing their pit stops, as the Core Sim Racing GT3 car, they are in the pits as well, so they're making their pit stops. So now the GT3 cars making all of their pit stops. But at the front of that GTC class is Core Sim Racing GTC with the 311 car at the moment. They've yet to stop in that class. You would have thought they'd be stopping on this next lap. You would have thought, as they're coming around now in towards the pit lane, will they come into the pits? Yes, they will. They're taking it to the right hand side on pit entry, and they're going to make a stop from the lead of the GTC class at the moment.
Yeah, now the pit cycle for the GT3s and GTCs are beginning to happen. Just before you started talking about the GT3s and GTCs coming into the pits, the GTC leaders of Baggett Racing came into the pits, so I expect them to take the overall race lead by now. They're just coming into the start-finish line now, so they are going to be the GTC leaders at the moment. And really, the GT3s, we still have a battle between the 4X Racing, NAB Racing, and Blackadder Motorsports. They're still battling for which position is this? Let me do a quick check.
Okay, yeah, go on, Alan.
Yeah, they're just battling for the looks like 8th, 9th, and 10th position. But looks like they haven't pitted yet, so we'll see what happens after this.
Yeah, the Torrent Motorsports car of Kyle Williams was going side by side through the toe of the boot with Stephen Spantig in the Blackadder Motorsports 269 car. So those two were side by side for quite a bit of that that boot section of the track, but now able to sort themselves out. There's just four cars from the GT3 class at the moment who have not yet made pit stops. You've got Ben Kuipers in the Mad Cape Racing team. They are currently in the lead of GT3, and they're coming into the heel of the boot with NAB Racing right behind them by the looks of things. So they're a lap down on Mad Cape Racing at the moment. But Hawk Tim Racing, they're in second place in GT3. For them, just in the prototypes, we've got NKH and also Sim Racing for Holland. They're battling away, going into the heel of the boot here, going past some backmarking traffic of the GTC class. That was the 381 car of Torque Freak Racing in the GTC class. But now these two close together, battling over third place, that final position on the podium.
Yeah, so far pretty much now that the prototype classes, they're with their pits being done, they're pretty much going back into racing. But yeah, so far so good for most of them, and let's see what happens after the pit cycles are done with the GT3s and GTCs as well.
Well, Sim Racing for Holland, they look to be a little bit better through that first corner and now into the S's. What will they be able to make the move? They've got some back markers ahead. It's a GT3 car of the BMW as they go around the outside of that BMW. And well, NKH just able to pull out a little bit of a gap, obviously able to use a bit of a draft there. But into the chicane, NKH still keep on to that third place in class at the moment. But at the front at the moment in this race, it's Christian Challoner in the Blackadder Motorsports car. In GT3s, it's Mad Cape Racing yet to make a pit stop, and Baguette Racing in the lead of the GTC class. We're just going to step aside for a couple of moments while we have a quick advert break, but stay right here for the 3 hours of Watkins Glen in the Gathering of Tweakers Endurance Series, here live on iRacing Live in association with RaceBot TV. Take care, we'll be right back.
For iRacing to get Le Mans is huge. I mean, this is a unique event, a unique track where, you know, half of the track is public roads, so you can never test on it, you never get experience on it, and it's 8 miles in length, 4 minute lap time in a GT car. So, you know, even if you're here for an hour of testing, that's only 15 laps, and you're only gonna see the corner 15 times that day. The first section going through the Dunlop area is pretty unique. You know, it's got elevation change and off camber. Then you go down Mulsanne into the chicanes, and you know, the straights are unbelievably long. It's a tricky track, and you know, every year I've come here, this is my, being my fourth year, you learn something new every time.
We've wanted to add Le Mans to iRacing for a long time, and we've really been working hard towards it for the last 5 years. But really, things only came together in the last week leading up to this race. So it was a real scramble to put everything together. The majority of Le Mans is public roads. So when they're preparing for the 24-hour race, it's really the only time that we can visit to laser scan and photograph the track so that we can recreate it in iRacing. We work closely with the ACO to get essentially exclusive access to the facility and everything that we needed to get the laser scanning and photographic reference that we need to create the track. We were very fortunate to be at Le Mans at the most important time of the year and gain that experience of being there. And we're going to really do the best we can to put that into our work and making sure that the Le Mans in iRacing is the best Le Mans, the most exciting and accurate recreation of the track possible.
Welcome back to the 3 hours of Watkins Glen here on iRacing Live in association with Racebot TV. It is the Gathering of Tweakers Endurance Series, round three of this series. My name is Paul Smith. Alongside me is Alvin Nieves with Hugo Louis on the cameras. And well, we've just had the final of the pit stops, and that was of the GT3 class, so everything is in order at the moment. So at the lead of this race at the moment, it is Blackadder Motorsports in that 166 car, 11.7 seconds ahead of Frederick Rasmussen in the Court Sim Racing car, with NKH in third. And in your GT3 class, you have Mad Cape Racing Team in the 274 car. They are in the lead of the GT3 class, with Core Sim Racing in second in the 211 car. Claudio Klima at the wheel of that car. Euphoria Racing White, they are in third place at the moment. Francisco Carnes Ruiz at the wheel of that car. And in the GTC class, it's Baguette Racing in the lead of that class, with Torque Creek Racing in second place in the 381 car. Court Sim Racing 311 GTC car in third place in that class. And we're going to stay with the GTCs, because we've got a battle going on between the 383 of ABL Endurance Team and also the 357 of Blue Line Motorsports Pro Speed Competition. Oh, that's a bit of a mouthful. Brett Trussin versus Richard Simpson. That's battling it out over that 9th, 10th place in the GTC class. And Alvin, we've seen a lot of action going on. We've seen another penalty as well for somebody. I'm just having a look here. Well, I can tell you, just in this race, we've had Avid Chronic Racing. They've had a stop and go for avoidable contact. They were done there, and Spirit of Lamar are currently under investigation as well for an unsafe rejoin. So that's a lot going on there for the stewards of this race. But it's been a lot more intense for the stewards this race, unfortunately, hasn't it? Just to say that the 357 car almost going to the back of the 383 ABL Endurance Team car.
Yeah, the stewards I've been really busy this race, considering the nature of, like I said again, it's a really fast and flowing track, so you will get a lot more incidents because of that. And as a matter of fact, the Spirit of Le Mans got a black flag because on an unsafe rejoin a couple of minutes ago.
And well, we had ABL Brett Trussin go really wide in turn one there, so that's allowed the Blue Line Motorsports Richard Simpson move stick, so he's moved up a position now in that GTC class. So the battle there, but up at the front, NKH, they're battling away still with Sim Racing for Holland. This battle has been going on for a little while now, and Sim Racing for Holland looking to have a good exit now out of the toe of the boat, down towards the heel of the boat, looking to go late on the brakes into that right hander, but not able to make it move at the moment. But they're coming up to the NAB GT3 car that's recovering after that incident earlier on, and NKH just running a little bit wide, and that's allowing Sim Racing for Holland to have a look, but not able to get alongside at the moment. But Sim Racing for Holland certainly looking busy, trying to make that move stick. And now as they come into the final corner, NKH having to go on the inside of the NAB car, and that's going to give them a slow exit because they've had to go tight. And here comes Sim Racing for Holland down the middle of the three of them, trying to go now to the outside of NKH into turn one. Can they make that move stick down into turn one, that right-hander, but not able to keep that place. But now going up through the S's, NKH are right underneath the rear wing. Sim Racing for Holland are right under the rear wing of the NKH car. Through the S's they go, but of course the slipstream, the draft, that is going to affect your grip levels through the S's, and just dropping back a little bit with Sim Racing for Holland. As I can tell you, just looking at our race control thing, Spirit of Le Mans, they're going to have a stop and go penalty for an unsafe rejoin in this race. So that was at turn two, so unfortunate for them to get another penalty on top of having that damage as well.
Yeah, was unfortunate, but good battle between the third and fourth.
Oh, Sim Racing Fallen just going down the inside. Sorry, Alvin. Down the inside of NKH Motorsports. NKH Racing, sorry, and taking advantage of them just running a little bit wide into the toe of the boat and making it through, and also getting that Hawk car, that Hawk Sim Racing car, between them as well, so able to pull out a little bit of a gap straight away for Sim Racing for Holland, and well, that's good work for them to take advantage of that little mistake there.
Yeah, definitely a good heads up by Sim Racing for Holland, and to take an advantage going into the into the boot section, but it looks like the NKH Racing is coming into the pit as well.
Yes, yeah, so they had an early pit stop, a short pit stop to start with in this race, so they are out of sequence from everyone else. So this is their second pit stop at the moment in this race. So they're on pit road at the moment, so losing out in that battle. Obviously they were trying to just push hard to have a good inlap, but here they are now, Nicholas Helm at the wheel in the pits at the moment, so they're making their pit stop at the moment, so that's released the Sim Racing for Holland car, and well, just going to see where they come out now from this pit stop. They should be nearly ready to come out now after making that pit stop, still in there at the moment, so maybe a little bit of damage or something on that car, because it's a little bit of a longer pit stop for NKH Racing. So where they go now?
Yeah, they're coming out of the pits now, so they're either get a slight bit of damage and they decided to come into the pits, or like you said again, since they came into the pits a little bit earlier than everybody else, they're just out of sequence and trying to get this to work now.
Well, they've come out just ahead of in 7th place in classes, another one, Darren Seal in the Legends Racing car, he's on pit road, so the prototypes, a couple of the prototypes making pit stops here at the moment, and well, just have a look through the field, everyone's pretty spread out at the moment, which is, well, it's kind of normal for an endurance race to have just the field spread out a little bit. I'd say the closest battle at the moment is actually Matt Warmington in the 155 car, in the Blue Flag Racing prototype, and FRT Hawker with Francisco Gonzalez, who of course had that stop and go penalty, and right behind them is in fact Frederick Rasmussen in the second place prototype.
Yeah, so far, yeah, there is a, now at this point in the race, we're pretty much all close to halfway through the race. Now pretty much all the teams are starting to relax a little bit as the whole field is more spread along the racetrack compared to the beginning of the race. So now pretty much everybody is able to pretty much run their own race, hit their marks. Of course, you're gonna encounter traffic here and there, but it shouldn't be as hectic as the first hour of the race.
Yeah, absolutely. With the field being spread out, you'll pretty much get traffic at every part of the lap, but at least they're not big clumps of cars that you're going to be catching up to as well. FRT Hawker still trying to keep just on the back of that Blue Flag racing car of 155, just having a few connection issues as the 155 car actually of Mark Warmington, so let's hope that they don't end up dropping out of this one, because it'd be a shame to have them drop out here. But well, we're on to another lap, and as you say, we're nearly at halfway stage of this race, and this is pretty much the closest battle on track at the moment between these two.
Yeah, this is one of those points that once you're halfway through the race, as a team, you're trying to check all the things that you need to do for the next stop. In this case, most of the teams should only have one more stop to go. And you as a driver are trying to pick your spots to see where you can gain some time.
Oh, there was a little bit of contact there. It was one of the GTC cars just getting into the side of that FRT Hawker car. Going onto the back straight, they were going three wide, and well, it was the car on the outside that had to avoid the grass, cut across the front of the FRT Hawker car, and they got into the side of that GTC car, the 387 car. Luckily, nobody ended up in the wall, but that was a pretty scary moment at that time for the 387 car of the Orange Devils.
Yeah, that's part of what I was saying. You as a driver are trying to pick your spots here and there now that the field is pretty much spread out, where you can overtake and where you cannot overtake. And I, from previous experience on multi-class racing, it's really easy now to lose your concentration since now it's pretty much all spread out. And so now is the time for all drivers to keep their head in on the track and make sure that their cars are still able to be in good condition, because most of them they have the as one of the things that we have on this series is driver swap, so you don't want to hand over a mangled race car to your teammates as well.
FRT Hawker looking down the inside now of that Blue Flag Racing prototype car, and well, they're going to go side by side into the S's, and this is not going to be for the faint of hearted. Through here, through the S's they go side by side, and of course you've got the marbles there, and there's a contact with the barrier for FRT Hawker, I do believe, and they are having to fall back in line now just to try and get that draft, trying to look down the inside into that chicane, and well, just not able to make that move stick, but surely just getting a little bit of damage there from running into the barriers at the top of the S's.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that there's gonna be some damage, and may not be as significant as it looked, but now this is the part of iRacing's build that we start seeing all these marbles and particles playing a huge part into racing. Now if you go outside of the racing line, now this is the time that you see those small things that iRacing has put in, those particles and marbles, play a huge part into the racing as well.
Absolutely, and as cars go onto the dirt and go onto the grass, it draws dirt onto the track, so you have that. You have the discarded rubber as well off the line as well, so that's bringing those cars in. And we're just going to have a look also at the 274 Madcap Racing. They are in second place in class, because they managed to get ahead of the Euphoria Racing light car of the 222. So that's for position, that's for second place in class. So GT3 at the moment, looking quite a close battle there at the moment, although they've got a prototype between them, so that gap has just pulled out a little bit. Just to let you know also, Ben Gregory of the Avid Chronic Racing, they have got another drive, they've actually got a 30 second stop go penalty for a avoidable contact, so they're having to serve a penalty again. That's their second incident in this race, so really not going well for the Avid Chronic Racing team.
Yeah, absolutely. This is one of the things that race control always had to keep in mind. When a team is involved in multiple incidents, it's kind of annoying sometimes trying to let them know that, hey, try to be safe. And it'll be nice to see, as we have a battle here for precision, looks like.
Yeah, FRT Hawker going down the inside, the 142 car going down the inside of Blue Flag Racing in that 155 car. So that's for position. They have moved up now to 10th place in class. They've got Legends Racing right behind them as well. So Darren Seal having to recover after that bit of a disaster with the incident of the contact earlier on. So the left-hand side of that car still looking a little bit damaged, but well, now they're up behind the Blue Flag Racing prototype car.
Yeah, and as I was saying, trying to finish what I was saying regarding penalties. Usually when you have a second incident with a team, you're trying to let them know, hey, you know, take it easy. Most of the time, the first time you are involved in an incident, you're not going to get the same penalty. You may get double, and maybe a warning that next time you are involved in an incident, you may get disqualified from the race as well.
We've got a battle for second place in GTC. It's the 381 car of Top Freak Racing They are in second place at the moment, but the Cork Sim Racing 311 car is in third and right behind them, and they've got a GT3 car catching up to lap them as well. So this battle for second place in class, just getting involved with the GT3s is down that back straight they go. And these rough C specs, they're not exactly a slow car down that straight, but it's through the corners where the GT3 car will have a have an advantage, as we've got another penalty for Francisco Gonzalez with a black flag, and this time a 60-second stop-go penalty for avoidable contact. So an absolute disaster for them in that car. Which one is that? That will be which one is that? That's the 142 car, the FRT Hawker car. That's is going to have to make a stop-go penalty. But yeah, that battle in GTC, that's still ongoing at the moment, just through the boot of this lap. And well, at the moment, 381 is in that second place, but Corsim Racing with Dominic Engel in third place, just trying to get that position and to make up another place onto the second step of the podium.
Yeah, and now we are on board on the 311 Core Sim Sport. Now they're going to get to start a lap and also battling fourth position as well with the Torque Freak Racing car of Sasha Lamp. So let's enjoy a good lap around Watkins Glen with the Core Simsport car.
Yeah, absolutely. We're getting to see this fantastic facility here at Watkins Glen. Of course, it's a historic track. Is this track? It's of course held the U.S. Grand Prix quite a few times in the 60s and early 70s as well. So. Yeah, it's as we say, a historic track, opened in 1956, so it's one track that everyone seems to love to go into. I know I personally like driving at this track, but yeah, that Core Sim Racing car of the 311 Dominic Engel, still behind the Torque Freak Racing entry of the 381 Sasha Lamp, so at the moment just holding station.
Yeah, so far so good for them. They're still now they're trying to negotiate. Letting the prototypes go by as well, while also maintaining their position. And looks so far so good for them.
So as we're going down now through the heel of the boot, and really just coming on towards the end of this lap now. Into this left hander, you've got two left handers at the end. There's already a little bit wide, is the 381 Torque Freak Racing, and that's going to let Dominic Engel have a look down the inside into the penultimate corner, and that's going to be a change of position for second place in GTC, as the 381 is going to look down the inside, but they've got the NAB racing car there as well. So just getting involved there is a GT3, and Core Sim Racing once again able to use the traffic that was there and able to just get a little bit of a gap on that Torque Freak Racing entry.
Yeah, this is a little bit of a reverse of how you use traffic as a slower class to overtake somebody, because usually most of the time you hear about using slow classes as picks to overtake cars or kind of pinch them for the racetrack, but this is a little bit of a different dynamic of how you use a faster class to your advantage to overtake cars in front of you.
Absolutely. Sim Racing for Holland, they're currently in fourth place, but they're pretty close to Team Hoisingveld Engineering of Christian Kewitt in their car, so that is a battle for position for third place overall in this race. Pretty close between them, just under a second between the two of them as they go across the line. The leaders, Blackadder Motorsports, are just slowly eking out a little bit more of a gap as this race goes along. They're now 17 seconds ahead. So as I say, it's Blackadder Motorsport, the 166 car. They are in the lead of this race, of course, in racing. In second place, the 311 car, Frederick Rasmussen. Third place, Christian Kiewit in that Team Hosek Belt Engineering car. They are in third, but as we say, sim racing for Holland, Ruben de Wit right behind them in fourth place. In your GT3 class, you have Court Sim Racing with the 211 car. They are in first place in class with Mad Cape Racing Team in second place in the 274 car, although they are under investigation at the moment for an incident, so we'll keep an eye on that one. Euphoria Racing White, they are in third place in the 222 car in the GT3 class. And in the GTCs, well, it's Baguette Racing still in the lead of that race for them, with Court Sim Racing 311 car of Dominic Henkel in second place. Top Creek Racing, as we saw earlier, down to third place in class with the Orange Devils. They're not too far behind them now, so the Orange Devils, they had a good race last time, they finished second in class, so they'll be hoping to just get a move up into that podium spot at the moment. And as we say, it's all pretty much spread out at the moment in this field. And the closest battle is that Sim Racing for Holland battle with Team Hosek Belt Engineering, so we'll keep an eye on that one at the moment. But the leader, as I'm talking, has come into the pits for his second stop, Christian Chaloner. It'd be interesting to see if they do switch. Yes, they do. So Tommy van der Gucht comes into that car, the 166 car of Blackadder Motorsports. They're changing drivers, so that is now, because of course we've got about an hour and 24 minutes left in this race. You do have lap limits for the amount of laps that these drivers can do in this race.
Yeah, it should be pretty much any team that hasn't done any changes in terms of drivers, this should be the time to do it now, because one thing they don't want to get is finish the race in a good position and then get disqualified because one of the drivers exceeded their time limits.
We of course saw that, unfortunately, in the first race of this season. I can tell you that in the prototypes, the maximum amount of laps that they can run is 77 laps. The GT3s is 74 laps, and the GTC class is 69 laps. So those are the limits for one driver to be able to run in this race at the moment. And Blackadder Motorsports have come out in fourth place overall at the moment. Don't forget, there is live timing available at the moment, and it is livetiming.nickfeason.nl for that. And don't forget, of course, that we're going to thank once again Anwen Designs for the graphics and Istvan Balor for the camera, these excellent cameras that you're watching on this coverage. And well, at the moment we have the 111 car, Course in Racing, currently in the lead, still staying out for yet another lap of this race.
Yeah, pit cycles are going now on for the prototypes. Should be after this, they pretty much all the teams should have one more stop, so we'll see how each team now plays their strategy as part of how to finish this race.
As well, 4X Racing. Do you know what? I haven't really mentioned 4X Racing this race, so sorry to those guys, but they're in the pits now for their pit stop with Vincent Brehm getting into that car as they leave the pits now. 31 and a half seconds. You're looking at about 30 seconds for the driver stop to take place, so slightly longer pit stops this time by, but out they go in that 4X Racing car. And just looking through the field, we've still got this battle now for second place as it is at the moment because of these pit stops. Team Hosek Belt Engineering in second with Sim Racing for Holland in third. There's about a second between them at the moment.
Yeah, pretty much most of the cars have been spread out throughout the second stint for them. Now the pit stops are going there, maybe a little bit out of cycle and all that, but really the only battle on track so far has been the 178 and 151 that they have been battling now for a while. So we'll see where they end up after the pit stops are done.
Well, I could tell you that Team Hosek Belt Engineering they look like they're going to be getting a drive-through penalty for avoidable contact. So, yeah, the 178 car getting a drive-through penalty. So, Sim Racing Volland, they're coming into the pits at the moment. Rudy De Witt is coming into the pits for their pit stop. But, well, Team Hoisetbelt Engineering are now going to have to come through. Well, do they make the pit stop first and then do the drive-through penalty? Or do the drive-through penalty first and then come round for another lap and do the pit stop?
Well, I'm pretty sure that you're supposed to serve your penalty first and foremost. It'll make the most sense, of course, and then you will do the pit stop, as you cannot serve both of them at the same time. Plus, you also have a set amount of time that you gotta serve the penalty, so it should make more sense to serve the penalty first and then come and do your pit stop.
Sim Racing for Holland, they've changed drivers now. Dennis Duna is at the wheel for that car and comes out in fifth place at the moment in this race, right behind a GTC car. So not the best pit exit for them to get stuck behind that GTC car, but there's no way to get around them in the first part of that S's, because it really is just one line through there. It's a tight way, tight through there with those barriers, crash barriers, so close to the track.
Yeah. Since we pretty much have more than half race go on, not only the barriers, but you also have all the particles and marbles going in, so getting a little bit offline, especially for GT3s and GTC cars, may be a little bit off an adventure, given that they don't have that as much downforce as the prototype cars have.
And Hoisetbelt Engineering coming onto pit road now, so will they be serving that drive-through penalty first? We're about to find out. They go down pit road at the speed limit, 44 miles an hour, and yes, they are serving that drive-through penalty, so they've got to come into the pits once again yet, but they are still in second place in class, but now looking at about 30 seconds behind the leader, Frederik Rasmussen, and that's a disaster for them, really, because they wanted to be battling up at the front, and it's not been their day so far for Team Hoisetbelt.
That's been kind of unfortunate for them, how things have been going on so far. Although them and Core Sim Racing, they haven't pitted yet. So yeah, it's been pretty much a little bit disappointing for them how things have been going on so far. But I'm pretty sure they will be able to regroup, and there's still a long ways to go in this race, and by the looks of things, they should get some good points here, and yeah, pretty much get on with the race and then think about next round as well.
And well, we've got a battle here for what's this, 9th and 10th place. Mark Warmington in the Blue Flag Racing prototype and the Legends Racing driver of Darren Seal. They're, as I say, battling out for 9th and 10th place at the moment. And well, it looks like we're not going to see a battle here, because Mark Warmington is coming onto pit road for his pit stop. So denied that opportunity of a battle between those two prototype teams. But as we say, Mark Warmington coming onto pit road.
Yeah, it's always kind of funny that we get getting excited for seeing pits during pit cycles and then getting broken up because they're coming into the pits. But this is part of endurance racing. Everybody has their own strategy and they got their own program, and they're just sticking to it and just making sure that it works and hopefully get them a good finishing position as well.
Pros Racing Sport, the 176 car, they're about 1.5 seconds behind at the moment of the NKH car. We've got a battle also in the GT3 class. That's the Racing Lions of Arno Gibben, I have to apologise, and Braith Morrow. That is a battle for 8th and 9th place in class at the moment. To Racing Lions, they did a good job last time out and just not quite on it this time in this round of the championship, but Blackadder Motorsports with the 269 car pretty close behind them at the moment, just about a second between them at the moment.
Yeah, it looks like this is pretty much a going on But so far, so good for everybody trying to get their things straight out. Pretty much they're going through traffic now. Everybody is trying to settle down as well. So now it's just a matter of getting everything together, trying to hit your marks, trying to not get into trouble as well, and try to get a strong finish whenever possible.
And of course, most teams are doing the driver swaps in this round of pit stops. How difficult is it for the second driver who's coming in to basically be at the pace of the leaders straight away when the track is completely different to how they last drove it in practice? How difficult is that?
It could be kind of difficult depending on the mindset that you are. Of course, it does require a different mindset, because whenever you start a race, you can be your adrenaline is kind of pumping really high, and you know that you're gonna be really close to your class and to each other. So you gotta be a little bit more careful. Whereas when you're doing the driver swap, the driver that's coming in, they gotta have the mindset that as soon as they get into the car, they gotta be going 100%. There's really no time to try to warm up or anything like that. It's just get in the car, get on it, keep the pressure on, keep on with the program. And at times it can be kind of hard for somebody to do this, but it's also really important that to understand that you get in the car and you gotta keep on with the program. And conversely, it's also when you're the driver handing over the car, you also gotta keep in mind that you gotta keep things as clean as possible, because the last thing you want is to be the driver that because of something that you did and screw it up for the whole team, and you don't want to be that driver.
And speaking of not wanting to make mistakes, we've got a drive-through penalty for the 274 car. That's the second place GT3 car, Mad Cape Racing. They are second place in class, as I say, and I'm just having a look to see the gaps between them. There's about 7 seconds between them and Euphoria Racing White. So actually, you would say that they would lose at least one place, maybe even two places, with the drive-through penalty.
Yeah, as I was saying, you don't want to be the driver making mistakes, but unfortunately, it's part of this. We're humans, and sometimes we make mistakes. But if you're gonna make a mistake, at least let it be a small one and not be a race-ending mistake.
Well, we're just going through now, so it'll be interesting to see when they take that drive-through penalty, because of course you have got to, as you said, there's got a set amount of laps. It's about three laps, isn't it, that they've got to take that penalty in. So, Mad Cape Racing at the moment still staying out there. Ben Kuyper's in at the wheel of that car at the moment in second place in class. Just having a look through the field. Who should we look at next? Because, as I say, once again, you get this in endurance racing. You get periods where there's intense battles, and then you've got other periods where you've got like this, where everyone's just spread out a little bit, you know, just a little bit of gaps here and there. And I suppose that's one good thing for the drivers, even though you've got to be absolutely on the edge all of the race. When you get times like that where there's a little bit of a gap, you can just relax a little bit and just not as well. We've got 288. What's happened there? 288 car are onto pit road. At the moment, the Torrent Motorsports car of Kyle Williams are there into pit road. Oh, missing their pit stall as well. So they are on pit road at the moment, making a pit stop. So interested to see if this is a scheduled one or whether it's damaged. Well, they're changing drivers. Simon Melhuish getting into the wheel of that car now, of the 288 Torrent Motorsports car. But they're the first really of the GT3 cars, although there is another GT3 car on pit road at the moment. But leader of the GT3 class. In fact, we'll go through the field at the moment. So the top three in each class. So at the front of the field at the moment, it's the 111 car of Court Sim Racing. Frederik Rasmussen at the wheel of that car. They are in the lead at the moment. Team Hosikveld Engineering, they are in second place. Have they actually, did they serve that drive-through penalty yet? They must have. Yeah, they did. Yeah, they did serve that drive-through penalty. So they've got a pit stop to come up. Yes, back at the Motorsports. They are in third place in the 166 car. So in the GT3 class, you've got the Court Sim Racing 211 car in first place there. Claudio Klima at the wheel there once again. Mad Cape Racing, they are in second place, but they've got a drive-through penalty to come up yet for avoidable contact in the 274 car. Euphoria Racing right there in third place in class in the GT3 class in the 222 car. And in the GTC class, Baguette Racing still at the front of that field. They now have a 43-second gap over the second place car of Core Sim Racing in the 311 car. And in third place, it's Torque Freak Racing in the 381 car. Sasha Lamp at the wheel of that car. And I'm going to ask Hugo which car we're going to look at the moment, because we've got a couple of cars that are within sort of second and a half between them, just looking at the standings. Fabian de Jong in the 208 car looks pretty close at the moment. NAB Racing car, they are behind Euphoria Racing White, who are third in class. So it might be worth looking at those two there, as like I say, about a second and a half between them at the moment, Al.
Yeah, so far, battle with 208. Let me get it here on the screen. Yeah, battle of 208 of NAB Racing and the High Octane Motorsports with King Salvensen. Pretty much that's the closest battle so far on the racetrack, as pit cycles are pretty much going on for most of the classes, even though the GTC and GT3s can go a little bit longer, but you may have some cars trying to get the jump on pit cycles depending on where they are standing in traffic, and that could also play a huge role in when you choose when to pit and when not to pit, depending how things may go ahead. If you think you're gonna lose too much time going into traffic, might as well get on the pits and try to open that gap in terms of traffic and view, and try to get as much of a clean track as possible.
Well, that's it. I mean, it's all well and good if you're stuck up behind traffic to come into the pits, but got to come out and find yourself some clean air as well. So you've got to have your teammates there looking to see who it would be that you would be coming out around. So it's important, as you say, to get that clean air when you exit the pits, so you can get some good laps in, get on those fresh tyres, and be able to make up some time on your rivals. As Fabian de Jong just putting the wheel onto the grass there on the exit of the heel of the boot, but still just coming through lap traffic at the moment. That car is one of the GTC cars, so just going past them at the moment. That was Brett Trotin in the ABL car that they went past and lapped. As one of the BMW GTC cars, GT3 cars is coming in. That's Ben Kuipers from Mad Cape Racing Team. And is that for their drive-through penalty? I don't believe it is.
Yeah. Trying to answer one question regarding when you get a clean air regarding on the racetrack. Me personally, when I'm trying to manage traffic, I try to take it easy, since you don't need to be pushing at the limits, especially when the field is so spread like this that you're not really battling for position on the track, and most of the time it can get the change for positions now are gonna take place most of the time on the pits. I really do like whenever I'm going through traffic, when I got my spotter just letting me know when I'm gonna have that clean air, and one of the best things that I can get to hear from my spotter is when he tells me that I'm gonna have a full clean map, no traffic at all. It's like a cat seeing a laser pointer. You pretty much know that you can just go for it and see what's the best you can do, as the 111 of Core Sim Racing is coming into the pits. The overall leaders are coming into the pits.
Well, yeah, because I was going to say, Team Heusinkfeldt have been in, and changed drivers to Henry Gross. Fredrik Rasmussen, the leader of the race, coming across the line there. He had a 37 second lead going on to this lap. So it'll be interesting to see how this goes, because of course Blackadder Motorsports, they have had their second pit stop, because it's Tommy Vandergucht who's at the wheel of that car. But now Juha Pekkalammi is getting into the wheel of that Court Sim Racing car, and it's going to be quite close as this, because like I said, they were about 37 seconds. It takes 30 seconds to change driver here, so that lead battle is going to be really close when they exit the pits, depending on if they have to fix the damage. And we're still waiting here, and away they go. 31 seconds for that pit stop. Core Sim Racing back out, and indeed they have lost that lead. Blackadder Motorsports with the 166. Tommy Vandergucht has taken the lead, and Juha Pekkalammi now is into second place. So that's a change of position in the pit stops, and that's worked out well for Blackadder Motorsports.
Yeah, there's like I said before, most of the change of positions now are gonna take place on the pits. Is pretty much it's all spread out, and so yeah, it's all gonna be now. It's gonna be all about pit strategy. And just on a side note, wanna say congratulations to Juha Pekkalammi, as he was chose by Twitch, and he's also a partner. So there are good things going for him on his channel as well.
Absolutely, Juha Pekkalammi is certainly one of those people who are known across the Twitch network. But Euphoria Racing, just going to this battle in GT3, Euphoria Racing White in second place now after that drive-through penalty for Mad Cape Racing. So they are in second place. NAB are in third, as one of the FRT cars comes in to the pits for their pit stop in the prototype class. But this is the battle we're looking at the moment, the GT3 class battle for second place in their class. Euphoria Racing with Francisco Cadenas Ruiz at the wheel, and NAB Racing with Fabien Dion at the wheel of that BMW. And now looking in the draft, is he quite close enough to make a move going on the inside into the chicane? Not really going into the chicane there, because it's not really a big enough braking zone to be able to throw it completely down the inside from that far back. But through the carousel, getting caught up behind one of the SRN cars, the GTC class, and that is going to allow NAB to catch up a little bit. But again, themselves can just get caught up behind that SRN Motorsports car of Scott McGarvey.
Yeah, and well, it looks like
down the inside!
He got it.
Yeah, fantastic. Took the opportunity of that little mistake there, and Fabien Dion down the inside, and that is second place in class now for the NAB Racing, back to where they were at the start when they had that little incident.
Yeah, it looks like Francisco got a little bit sideways going into the boot section, and Fabien de Jong just took advantage of that mistake and was able to take second place. Now let's see if he can pull away from third place.
Yeah, Euphoria Racing White, though, they won't want to give up that second place without a fight, but Fabien de Jong has been setting faster lap times than Francisco Cadenas Ruiz in that Euphoria Racing White car. So Fabien de Jong, even with the damaged car, is just able to slowly just eke out a little bit of a gap there as one of the prototypes comes up to lap that Euphoria Racing White car.
Yeah, seems like he's able to pull away now, as we have one of the prototypes going by them as well, and looks like, yeah, all good. all good with them. They given some space, and but that allowed the third place car to close a little bit now. But like you said, Fabian de Jong has been laying down faster laps consistently. So I think it even with that traffic letting third place close by, he will still be able to pull away.
Just running wide through the chute into the boot section is that Euphoria Racing white car. They seem to be struggling to make the apex in this car at the moment. Maybe just got a little bit of debris onto the cars, a little bit of the marbles and dust that gets kicked up onto this track. It takes a little while to rub those marbles off the tyres, and it does certainly affect the grip levels that you have in these cars.
Yeah, now there comes a point in the race that you may see people taking less risk as, unlike previous builds, there wasn't such a thing as marbles and particles off the track, and now as we see Francisco Cardenas coming into the pits for his final pit stop.
Yeah, so we're just on the hour mark in this race, and that's the Euphoria Racing white car coming into their pit stall now for their second stop of the race. And well, you would think, is there going to be a driver change in this as well? Because they have already had the other driver in there at the moment. So Francisco, is he going to stay in the car? No, it's going to be Juan Segarra getting into that car now to finish off the race for Euphoria Racing White. So they're in the pits at the moment. We're going to see how long this pit stop is. It'll be a little bit longer in these GT3 cars, I do believe. So they'll be sat in the pits for a little while yet. But on the track, the 272 car, Mad Cape Racing, they're having to make up. It's not that one. It's the other car that had the penalty. So Mad Cape Racing, the 272 car, is just behind the Top Creek Racing GT3 car, the 281. And that is a battle for fourth place in class at the moment.
Yeah, with the pit cycles going on, most of the GT3 cars should be coming into the pits for what should be their last pit stop for most of them. So we'll see if any are gonna have any change in drivers. Pretty much it should be last stop and should be good to the finish. So pretty much all the GT3 cars should be, once they come out of the pits, they should be 100% for their drivers and hope to get the best finish possible.
Absolutely. So we're moving through the field now, just looking here. This does appear to be the closest battle at the moment, and we're going to be seeing if they even these two come into the pits this time. By the answer is no, they're going to stay out on track at the moment. Another lap for these two GT3 cars. Got Bram Renners in the Top Freak Racing car. They are in that fourth place, and Frederick Elmstrom in the Mad Cape Racing 272 car. They are battling for that fourth place, although just losing a little bit of gap. Although the black traffic has slowed down Bram Renners through the S's there, so Mad Cape Racing now just getting a little bit of run through the S's there. Can they make that move going into the chicane? The answer is not for the time being. So they're coming through the chicane into the carousel, and we're still staying in position. What we're going to do is, because we've got him waiting there, we're going to bring in Dean Prescott now for a little bit of an interview here. Dean, we saw you driving, having a little bit of an incident at the chicane in that early part of that race, and just a second there, because the Mad Cape Racing 272 car was just having a look down the inside there, but staying behind for the time being. But Dean, just quickly, just give us your thoughts on the race so far for your team.
So far it's not too bad, actually. Weren't really expecting much from this race. Qualified on, I think it was about half a tank of fuel, which is why I was down in P8. The start caught us a bit off guard. I don't know if it caught you guys off as well, but...
Oh, Oh, I'm sorry, Dean. There's a little bit of contact between the Mad Cape Racing 272 car and the 281 Talk Freak Racing car. Mad Cape have made it through, but I think the stewards might have a look at that one there, because it was a bit of a robust move, shall we say, coming back on to the old circuit. And in fact, the Talk Freak Racing car comes onto pit road for their pit stop. But yeah, sorry about that, Dean. Just carry on. It did catch us out for sure with that start.
Yeah, caught me definitely out. Got up to two spaces from that, so 8th to 6th, so when the yellow flag come out. Just seen Darren running wide on a bit of a delivery replay. But yeah, then the whole restart again, that was, again, caught us all off guard, but again, picked up two more spots and thought, you know what, let's go and have some fun. Pushed for a little bit, trying to keep up with the guys. And then just saw the traffic coming and thought, here we go, this is my chance to get in there. So got in and amongst, using the traffic obviously to gain a couple of spaces. And then just touching that replay that you guys were just, oof! Yeah, just really just trying to maintain the pace really. Coming up on to take the lead, that was, I thought actually I was going to lose a place. Up through the S's, but no, managed to gain first and then went on from that.
And your car just looks like it's got a little bit of damage on the left hand side there, just a slightest bit of damage on the left hand side there, so nothing too bad that's affecting the car at all, is it?
From the initial contact, car spun around, I think it was perfectly fine. I think we had some rear end wing plate damage, but I think most of the damage come from the actual rough hitting us just after. But no, pace was still good, still had plenty of grip, turning in fine, so played on, went straight out for it again.
And well, you've got Darren Kirk at the wheel at the moment, and he's in 7th place at the moment. You said, as you said, you qualified 8th, so it is an improvement in this race. Just how do you see the last part of this race going? Because we've got 54 minutes of this race remaining. Do you think that maybe you can make a move on NKH, or are they just too far ahead at the moment?
Going off the pace of Darren, he's not had much time to practice, but yeah, his pace is there or thereabouts. Probably just a little bit behind where NKH are. Fingers crossed we can keep the guys behind, which I think was it Darren Seal in?
Yeah, Darren Seal is in that car at the moment.
Yeah, I don't know if Darren's actually got some damage. Darren Seal, sorry, he's got some damage on that, because as I was coming up to battle, he got caught up in a little bit of an incident. I don't know if he's got damage.
Well, just finally while you're here, anyone that you want to have a quick mention to as part of Friction Racing?
Yeah, quick shout out to the sponsor, obviously, Fanatec, Puma, V-Box from Race Logic, and Simple Race actually. It's a new, well, I wouldn't say new, but it's simulating place where you can go and just like a group of you get together on sims and just drive against each other, basically kind of like what we're doing now, but obviously you're all in one room. So
we're just seeing Darren Kirk has actually just lost control a little bit just into that little bus stop chicane there, but he's not made any contact with the Legends car, having to get onto the brakes as well. And that's brought them two right together, so we'll let you get off and have a chat with Darren, maybe just tell him to just keep focus and that. But all the best for the rest of the rest of the race there, Dean.
Yeah, cheers guys.
Well, that was Dean Prescott there, but as I said, Darren Kirk just losing the car through the bus stop chicane. But I tell you what, that Legends car did a very good job to avoid hitting the back of that Friction Racing car.
Yeah, definitely a good heads up, but trying to keep their head together. It's pretty much now, even though we have less than an hour to go, it's more going 100%, but also you gotta keep in mind keep in mind your surroundings and be able to take avoiding action if needed as well.
And we've had the Course Sim Racing 211 car onto pit road, and Mike Palach has taken the wheel of that from Claudio Klima. So good job done there by Claudio in this race so far. They come out currently in fifth place in class, but of course the four cars ahead of them have yet to make a pit stop in that class at the moment. So as we are at the moment, it is at the front of this race, it's still Black Adder Motorsports, the 166 car. They are in the lead of this race. Second place is the Core Sim Racing Triple One car. They're 12 and a half seconds behind the leaders of this race in second place. Third race, Sim Racing for Holland. They're doing another good job again in this race. And well, at the front of the GT3s, well, at the moment, Fabien de Jong is just coming in now. He's having his pit stop at the moment. So it is Ben Kuipers in the 274 car in that Madcap Racing team car. They are in the lead at the moment. In second place in GT3 at the moment is Frederik Elmstrong in the Madcap Racing team 272 car. So the two teammates there in first and second in class at the moment, but of course they've yet to have their pit stop. And in third place at the moment, well, NAB are still classed as third at the moment while they're on pit road, but Mike Palach will be coming around shortly to take that place for them. And in the GTC class, you still have Baguette Racing. We've hardly talked about them once again. They've done that good a job at the front of the GTC class. Evan Mallard is at the wheel of that car in the 356 car. In second place in GTC, Core Sim Racing with the 311 car. And in third place in GTC is Talk Freak Racing in the 381 car. So what we'll do is we'll just quickly step aside for a few moments just so we can get our breath back from this exciting race. And we'll have the conclusion of the 3 hours of Watkins Glen and the Gavrinor Tweakers Endurance Series here on iRacing Live and Race Spot TV. Don't go anywhere, we'll be right back after these short messages.
iRacing.com is a sim racing game that combines a true-to-life racing experience with an online community of virtual racers from all over the globe. iRacing offers a multitude of officially licensed cars and tracks, laser-scanned with millimeter accuracy. Their car models and mechanical systems are based on real-world physics and engineered in cooperation with manufacturers and race teams. iRacing's web-based interface allows members to compare stats and test drive any combination of car and track instantly. Their skill license system ranges from rookie to pro, ensuring members are always pitted against those with similar skill sets. Members are able to sign up for a weekly race series, compete in time trials, host a private race with friends, and participate in racing leagues created and run by the community. With over 60,000 members, iRacing works in partnership with renowned motorsport organizations like SRO Motorsports Group to deliver virtual races based on the real-life Blancpain GT Series. iRacing's Blancpain Endurance Series features team racing, giving members the ability to build a team and participate in races ranging from 3 hours to 24 hours. Additional partners include NASCAR, IMSA, V8 Supercars, IndyCar, allowing members to race in their very own 24 hours of Spa, Bathurst 1000, Daytona 500, and many more. iRacing.com, delivering the most authentic racing experience short of getting into a real race car.
We'll be right back. Truex on the outside, contact made. 56 slides it in at four. Who's going to be at the stripe? Dead even, give it to Ryan Truex. Truex is your winner over Tandy.
Welcome back to the 3 hours of Watkins Glen in the Gathering of Tweakers Endurance Series here live on iRacing Live, which of course is a race spot presentation for iRacing Live. My name is Paul Smith. Alongside me, as always, this race has been Alvin Nieves. I knew I'd get that wrong at some point, Alvin. And Hugo Louis is on the cameras there. And what we're looking at the moment is the battle for second place in GTC. That is David Barraclough in the Top Creek Racing car, the 381 car, and Nice Malmgren in the Core Sim Racing car, the 311 car. This, of course, as I say, is a battle for second place in class, and there's only 0.8 of a second between them at the moment as a few of the prototypes coming through to lap them.
Yeah, pretty much almost around 45 minutes to go now, and we're pretty much most of the positions may be settled down, but you never know what may happen. So for all teams now is just keep doing what you're doing and see if something happens to anybody that's running in front of you, and just take advantage of it now.
Absolutely, but when you've got a battle this close at the moment, as we say, for second place, there's only 0.7 seconds between them now, between Top Creek and Core Sim Racing. And when you've got a battle like this so late on, you do want to try and get that place, but also, as well, Top Creek run very wide through the toe of the boot, so Glen and Core Sim Racing get close right up now behind them for that battle. But you're on the one hand, you want to get that place, Alvin, but on the other hand, you want to make sure that you make it to the end with a good result.
Yeah, it's kind of one of those that you gotta pick your place and pick your time. Most probably Core Sim Racing are just waiting for something to happen to Torque Freak Racing and see if they can take advantage of it. But for the most part, there may come as the Torque Free Racing just ran a little bit wide. Oh, sorry, I was watching the broadcast instead of the live racing. My bad. But yeah, it may come a point that you just pretty much try to stay in the position that you have and see if you can take advantage of a mistake that happens later. Because when it matters is where you are positioned at the last lap of the race when you cross the finish line. Right now, there's still plenty of racing to go, so we'll see what happens.
David Barraclough in that Top Creek Racing car. just putting wheels on the dirt on the exit of turn one, but you can really see on this track how much it's rubbered in now. Of course, with this endurance event, the track will just keep on rubbering in, so these cars will be getting faster and faster on the laps. And also with the more rubber on the track, it'll mean that there's slightly less tyre wear as well, so they'll be able to push for longer, as that core sim racing car is looking really dangerous now behind them. Nice Malmgren trying to put the pressure on David Barraclough to try and get the place. David just runs a little bit wide onto the grass on the exit of the chute, now into the toe of the boot on this track, and course sim racing just having to get out of it a little bit there, because well, Top Creek were just a little bit slower mid-corner, and they've got a couple of guys behind them that are coming up to lap them as well, so this could disrupt this battle for position. Of course, as I say, it's for second place in GTC through the heel of the boot, and they've got the Legends car coming past to lap them, but it's going to have to go around the long way around the outside of them, and that'll put a lot of dirt and rubber onto those tyres because of the marbles offline. And well, that's just split up that gap a little bit. It's really up this battle for position a little bit at the moment, but I'm sure that when these two come past the top three car, that gap will close once again.
Yeah, there's pretty much most of the field has been pretty much even split. It's gonna, sometimes it could be hard when you find yourself in this situation that you're battling for position being the slower class and trying to let the fast cars go in by, even though it's only one car, or in this case they got two faster classes coming by. Sometimes it's kinda disruptive when this happens, but you must be able to keep your concentration at all times, and just remember that there will be a point in the race that it will come back to you, so you just pretty much gotta keep your pace, keep what you're doing, and just hope that it comes back to you at one point in the race later.
Absolutely. So Talk Freak just allowing that GT3 car of Kim Salveson in the high octane motorsports car to go past, and that's just allowed David Barraclough a little bit of gap, so that's worked out for him a little bit. He's only got half a second between him and the Cort sim racing car in third place, so these two still battling their way through the tour of the boat. And well, just having a look at the website here, the stewards haven't had to do anything for quite a while now, so everyone now just now that everything's sort of spread out a little bit, just calm down a little bit, and the stewards can enjoy this race now.
Yeah, I can say, as being one of the stewards for Neil, we do enjoy when the whole field settles down and they're doing their own race and they're minding each other. We really do enjoy that planned race. So I'm pretty sure these stewards on the other end of the triggers are now getting to relax a little bit and really just watch the race and enjoy all the battles that we have on the racetrack, as we are doing as well.
Now, don't forget that you can keep up to date with all of your favourite drivers if you want to keep an eye on them. You know, with Live Timing, that's livetiming.nickthiessen.nl. So that's where you can get all of your Live Timing action. So even if we're not showing your favourite driver at the moment, up to date with their race. And not to forget to quickly mention the sexy graphics on our screen here from Anwern Designs, and the excellent cameras are of course from István Balor. But we're going into the last sort of portion of this race, almost into the 37 and a half minutes left of this race. Just a little bit of a gap between these two now, between Top Freak and course sim racing in the GTCs. They've just settled down a little bit now between them, so about 1.2 seconds between them. So again, it's ebbing and flowing, and that's what you get with the endurance race, and it's fantastic, isn't it?
Yeah, this is kind of like a you give some, you take some. But yeah, this is the beauty of endurance racing, that sometimes you gotta give a little bit and just hope that it comes back. And I'll say like 95% of the time it does come back to you.
he was sliding through that corner was David Barraclough then. That left-hander onto the old circuit. So David Barraclough lucky not to lose the position there. But it's really brought Nees Malmgren onto the back of his car now. Going down the pit straight once again.
Yeah, they were playing a little bit of Formula Drift coming into the old part of the circuit, but he was able to keep it on the track. But like I was saying, this is something that you can give a little bit and then hope it comes back and scores as it shows that Torquefield just slid a little bit and Core Sim Racing now were able to close the gap, and looks like this battle is not over.
It's not over for sure, but they're just letting one of the prototypes go through our Core Sim Racing, and once again it's fallen well for the Talk Freak Racing car, because it's just allowed them to put a little bit of a gap on the Core Sim Racing car, as we've got a couple of drivers there. I can tell you Friction Racing have had a warning a little bit earlier on for an unsafe rejoin of the track. We've also had FRT Hawker, the 223 car, they've had a warning as well for avoidable contacts. And at the moment, the 140 FRT Hawkers International, they are under investigation at the moment. So possibly for car contact there. So a few cars just... So the steward's still having to do a bit of work here. And so they are keeping them busy there.
Yeah, it's never over for sure. But definitely a lot more... relaxed in the first hour of the race. I can tell you that for sure. But yeah, pretty much now most of the teams are now just doing their own race and trying to avoid any race ending incidents, as usually when at the beginning of the race, if you get a penalty, you can recover from it most of the time. But getting a penalty this late on the race can be really devastating for your end of the race.
Going into turn one then, Talk Freak Racing, David Barraclough in that second place for GTC. You have the Core Sim Racing car of Nees Malmgren in third place in class, going through the S's there. He's not able to get close enough at the moment, although this time looks like he's got a little bit of a better run through the S's. He's in the draft there. Is Nees going to be able to have a look down the inside into the chicane? He's decided against it for the time being, but he's really on the back of that Talk Freak Racing car at the moment, Alvin.
Yeah, now it's starting to... the Core Sim Racing, he's really starting to reel back the Talk Freak Racing of David Barraclough. So... will he be able to overtake complete the overtake at any point in the race? We'll see, but it looks like for the time being, he's pretty settled down. But don't discard that this battle is over yet.
Well, at the second place spot. Second place spot in this race, it's Team Huizingveld. They are battling away with who is it that they're battling away with? It's they're down to third place, but Core Sim Racing, they are currently in the lead. You have Pekalame, Blackadder Motorsports, so something's happened to them this lap. Have they been into the pits? They must have. Blackadder Motorsports at the moment have been into the pits here, so they're dropped down to third place in this race at the moment. And well, in the lead at the moment it is Juha Pekalame for Core Sim Racing in the 111 car, with Team Huizingveld Engineering, they should be in second place, which they are. But Huizingveld, they've got Blackadder right behind them at the moment. So that's really a close, intense battle for the second place. But of course, Team Huizingveld, they don't have to overtake... Blackadder Motorsports don't have to overtake Team Huizingveld, because Team Huizingveld have yet to pit again, because they will have to one more time.
Yeah, that is absolutely true. Blackadder Motorsports wear fresh tires. They can take it easy, knowing that team Heusinkveld Engineering will have to pit. But also they don't want to lose too much time because Corsin Racing was running in second place, and even though there was a nice gap between them, they don't want to lose that gap and make it closer than it should be.
Absolutely, because there's about 24 and a half seconds between Juha Pekkalamme and Henry Gross at the moment. So Black Adam Motorsports, I don't want to get held up too long, because if it goes too long, let's say look down the inside now. Black Adam Motorsports, ooh, was that a little bit of contact between them? Down the inside of Team Heusinkveld, but they've made the move. It was a robust move, but they're through now into second place ahead of Team Heusinkveld.
Yeah, it looks like they just went through, they want to take that position and dictate the pace. There was a little bit of contact, so we'll see what race control thinks about that as well.
Well, anyway, it wasn't race-ending contact or causing severe damage, but still, those two have now settled their differences for the time being. As well, in this GTC class, it's still raging as this battle between Talk Freak and Court Sim Racing for second place in GTC, as they've got a prototype just coming through the middle of them in the S's. And well, Talk Freak will be able to get the draft from that prototype now, just to help them out down the straight, because they need all the help they can get, because Course in racing were a lot faster onto that straight.
Yeah, definitely. Looks like now they are letting one of the prototypes go by. And for the GTC, trying to let cars go by going through the S's is kind of like a little bit. Could be a little bit of a problem as well, and they really do have to mind whenever they are also letting traffic go by as well. Make sure that they are not committed into the corner, because it could be a little bit of trouble for them as well.
So yeah, these two still battling away for position, and just going through the heel of the boot, and it's still, well, Talk Freak, I have to say a lot of props to them, because they are doing a fantastic job of keeping that second place ahead of Core Sim Racing, because we know how good the Core Sim Racing drivers are, and Nice Malmgren putting all the pressure on David Barraclough, but David able to stay ahead, although a poor exit through that left hand of the penultimate corner. Now onto the pit straight. Can David make that down the pit straight? Can he keep that position? And Nice is going to have a look down the inside, surely. Has a darts out, but decides against it into turn one. Maybe his best effort is through the S's, get a better run through the S's, and then make that move into the bus stop chicane.
Yeah, pretty much a nice battle going on, and yeah, major props to Talk Freak Racing too for keeping that second place, as they also are dealing with a prototype car splitting them going into the bus stop. But yeah, major props for them too for battling and making sure that if Course Sim Racing really wants that second spot, they're really gonna have to earn it today.
Yeah, it's going to be, but it's always more satisfying when you do make that position and it's been hard earned, because it's a relief. As now, down the inside through the chute is going, the Talk Freak have run a little bit wide there, but they're going to have the inside into the toe of the boot here at Watkins Glen for this 3 hours of Watkins Glen in the Catherine the Tweakers Endurance Series. Through the toe of the boot now they go, and David Barraclough just to stay ahead at the moment, as they've got enough of prototype going through. And Core going to have a look down the inside, going into the heel. Can they make that move? No, they can't for the time being. And all this time, they are just losing time hand over fist on the Baguette Racing team, who have now got, get this, a 1 minute 20 second lead over the second place GTC class car. That's incredible to have such a lead over another car in your class.
Yeah, definitely, but we've also seen that Packet Racing has been definitely the team to beat throughout this whole series, so In a way, yeah, it is. It is surprising that one car can get this big of a lead over their competition. But then again, we have Evan Millar and Jesse Ferrer and that Baguette Racing, and those two, they are really good with this C-spec. So, yeah, major, good kudos for him for putting for being on the lead of this race for so long and pretty much setting the pace for GTC as well.
I can tell you, just we did mention earlier that FRT Hawkers International, the 140 car, was under investigation. No further action. It was considered a racing incident with them and the 132 car, so all okay for the 140 car. They are currently in 11th place overall in this race, just 10 seconds behind the 10th placed car of Blue Flag Racing Prototype. But down the inside now goes Corsim Racing in the toe of the boot, and oh, he's getting so close to get the side by side down towards the heel. This, he's got to make this move stick now, hasn't he? Going into the heel, can he be later on the brakes? Down the inside into that right hander, and now finally they'll make that move. But of course, the next two corners are left handers, and David Barraclough is on the inside for those. Topfit Racing down the inside, the 381 car, the side by side through this left hander onto the old circuit. Now into the penultimate corner, it's a left hander once again. There's only really one line through here, and Topfit Racing are going to just stay ahead for the time being. Corsim Racing, though, trying to get that better line through the exit there into the final corner. This right hander, they've got a Prototype looking to overtake them as well. And Corsim Racing could use the draft off of them to maybe make the move, but no, deciding to stay behind Talk Freak Racing, looking, darting out to the right, trying to make that move stick, but for the time being, they're still behind David Barraclough in that Talk Freak Racing car.
Yeah, never say over till it's over, and looks like Corsim Racing is really starting to run out of patience, and now they really want to go for it, but David Barraclough, it's still keeping the car at the right places, and yeah, if Corsim Racing wants that spot, they will really have to fight for it.
Absolutely, this of course is the closest battle in the race. 24 minutes left in this race, and it's still Corsim Racing, the 111 car, in the lead overall, with Blackadder Motorsports in second place. Team Heusinkveld, the 178 car, are in third place, but only 4.5 seconds behind second place. We'll keep an eye on that one for you. In GT3, we have Corsim Racing, the 211 car, there in the lead. They have got a 21-second lead over NAB Racing, with Talk Freak Racing GT3 car, the 281, in third place. And then you've got Baguette Racing in the lead of the GTC class. And then this battle here, Talk Freak Racing and Corsim Racing, the 381 and the 311 car, battling it out for that second place on the GTC class, as the Corsim Racing car just loses the back end a little bit, side by side through that right hander going onto the old circuit. But once again, David Barraclough able to position his car perfectly and keep that place for the time being.
Yeah, definitely. Now this is a really nice battle between both of them, and they're showing the respect that they have for each other, but they're also understanding that this is the time to go and really making it interesting, and letting Torque Freak Racing car letting them know that this is not over yet, as they have the BMW Racing Lions going by them, and also that they will have a prototype going up into the S's. So let's see how all these four teams have handled this this moment.
Yeah, we have all three classes here in one camera shot there, as down the middle goes the prototype of the Sim Racing for Holland entry. Oh, going into that chicane there, Racing Lions just a little bit tight through the chicane there. That's allowed Corsim Racing to close up the gap to David Barraclough in that Top Freak Racing entry in the GTC class. Coming down now, down to the chute, into the boot section of this track. And still, it's absolutely neck and neck between these two. And, well, they've been together for what seems to be, 20 minutes now, these two? And still, David Barraclough doing a fantastic job of staying ahead. I don't want to give him the commentator's curse, and by me saying that, I've already given him the curse, but able to keep ahead of the Corsim Racing car for the time being.
Yeah, now they're pretty much down to what is a typical sprint race in the public servers of iRacing, so now it's pretty much a mentality of go now or go home, so we'll see how this ends.
Yeah, these two are pretty close. You've also got a close battle between the 222 car of Euphoria Racing White and Madcape Racing Team 274. Those two are pretty close together, but at the moment it's these two that is the closest battle on the track. And well, through that final corner, starting another lap once again. And David Barraclough, fantastic job so far. They've got some more lapping traffic coming through behind them. One of the prototypes, is that the Legends car? No, it isn't. It's the Friction Racing car. Pros Racing car. I'll get there eventually. Of Jason Marshall, who's going through the S's. That's very brave. You need a lot of commitment from and a lot of confidence that the car that you're going past knows that you're there.
Yeah, definitely, and also considering that the GTCs are pretty much, once they commit to the corner, they're pretty much...
Oh, contact!
No, and Corsim Racing just got... Yeah, that's unfortunate for the Corsim Racing guys. They were having a nice battle, and unfortunately, they just were involved with one of the BMWs going to overtake them.
Oh, it's an absolute disaster. I'm just trying to find out who that was. It was the 220 car of Joachim Svensson, who was going down the outside of Nice Malmgren. And going into that chicane, it's a pretty tight chicane, even though it's a quite fast one. There's only really one line through there. And, well, Svensson and Malmgren just getting together there. And unfortunately for us with this battle, it's come out worse for that Corsim Racing car, who are now, they're still in third place in class, in that GTC class, but they look to have a little bit of damage on that right-hand side because it was quite a heavy impact and it spun them round. But as I say, still in third place for the time being, so they've not lost a place in class, but it certainly cost them a lot of time in that battle.
Absolutely, it was unfortunate that this battle had to end this way, but this is part of endurance racing. Sometimes you get caught at the wrong place at the wrong time, and this is what just happened here.
So we'll now look at this GT3 battle. It's a 222 car of Euphoria Racing White, Juan Segura at the wheel of that car, and Madcape Racing Team, Kevin Vranken at the wheel of that 274 car. This is a battle for fourth place in class, in this GT3 class, and there's only 0.6 of a second between the two at the moment, so quite a close battle this, but Madcape Racing, we'll have a look at the lap times this time by, just to see how they compare. Across the line goes Juan now with a 1:49.7 and Kevin with a 1:49.5, so 0.2 faster. But Kevin just getting caught up there a little bit with going past that back marker, the Orange Devil's car.
Yeah, definitely. He got a little bit caught up, but and looks like it didn't really affect their his overall lap time as he caught the lap traffic coming out of the corner, and GTC just moved out of the way coming out of the corner, so they're still able to run their own race, and yeah, so far so good for them.
So coming through now down into the chutes, they've got one of the prototype class cars just going down the inside of them there. So that was Blackadder Motorsports, of course the leaders of this race. Blackadder Motorsports by 6.2 seconds. Team Heusenbach Engineering are in second place in this race. 6.2 seconds, like I say, between the two. And then there's Corsim Racing in third place in that 111 car. They are in that third place, 4.7 seconds behind them. So about 10.5 seconds covering the top three, so still pretty close to say we've nearly had 3 hours of racing, but this is the battle that we're looking at the moment, the GT3s. and it is Euphoria Racing White that are currently ahead of Madcap Racing, the 274 car, but they've got a prototype between them. That is the FRT Hawker 142 car. So that car's now going to go past them, but that's allowed them just to pull out a little bit of a gap, 1.2 seconds between them now for this battle for fourth place in GT3.
Yeah, absolutely. Pretty much most of the top three positions in all the classes should be all pretty much all settled down. So it's just in the midfield we're having some battles here and there, but so far it's been a pretty good race for everybody here. Yeah, there's been some incidents, but this is it's just part of what endurance racing brings to us.
Well, I'm just having a look at this. Team Heusinkveld Engineering in second place overall. They've only stopped twice for pit stops. So are they going to try and make it to the end, or are they going to have to make a splash and dash right at the end of this race? Because the other cars around them, all the rest of the prototypes have made at least three stops. So Heusinkveld maybe pull a fast one here and get that position by going one left stop.
Yeah, this is one of the advantages that you gain from pretty much having a good season so far, and considering that how far ahead they are in the points, they're just trying to see if this gamble can pay off. Although from the looks of it, the best they could get is second place unless something happens with the blackout in motorsports.
Yeah, so Blackout of Motorsports, as we say, now 7.3 seconds. Oh, in fact, Team Heusinkveld look like they're coming onto pit road, so obviously not able to go to the end. So, Juha Pekkalammi in the Corsim racing car moves up to second place overall in this race. So, he's now 11.9 seconds behind the race leaders. So, you would think that would be pretty much settled, but I'd be interested to see if Sim Racing for Holland can come out ahead of Team Heusinkveld Engineering. It should only be a short stop because they only need to have a splash and dash here, and away they go now after a 9.7 second pit stop. And Sim Racing for Holland, they're going to come round that first corner at the same time. They're going to be side by side going up into the S's, but Sim Racing for Holland just come out ahead into the S's of that Team Heusinkveld Engineering car. So that is third place overall for Sim Racing for Holland, but that battle will run because those two are pretty close together.
Yeah, definitely, but we also gotta put into consideration the how long the 178 has had their tires on versus Sim Racing for Holland, which I'm pretty sure that on the last stop they changed the tires. So Sim Racing for Holland should be able to pull away, and they should be able to secure third place now.
You would have thought that Team Heusinkveld wouldn't have taken tyres. They would have just done a splash and dash there, you would think, you know, because the time that it takes to do a tyre stop would be a little bit longer, surely, than just having to top up a fuel, but we'll have to wait and see. We've got a black flag, a 2 minute stop and go penalty for, and I quote, very avoidable contact. That's Nicholas Helm now. What team is Nicholas in? We'll have to find out for you. Just have a look through the orders here.
He's in it must AKH be with Racing.
Yeah, so it must have. Was it that incident? Was it that incident at the chicane? By the looks of it. Well, turn four anyway is what it was. So, So they've got a 2 minute penalty right near the end of this race because we've only got 12 minutes of this race remaining. And going through now, I'm just having a look at this Euphoria Racing white car because they've managed to pull out a little bit of a gap. So, yeah, the 191 car of NKH Racing, they have that 2 minute penalty in the final part of this race. I'm just having a look at the timing, so they'll definitely lose their one place because Adam Pyle is 1 minute 7 behind them. And there's quite a few cars actually behind Adam Pahl. They're pretty close together, so this could lose NKH a lot of positions here.
Yeah, absolutely. And this penalty this late in the race, it's really devastating. There's really no way you can come back from this type of penalty this late in the race. And from the looks of it, they're going to lose more than one lap, considering that the prototypes takes a minute 40 for them to complete a lap here. So they're going to lose a lap and then some.
So anyway, we've still got this battle going on, and now it's between the two Madcap Racing cars, the 274 and the 272. So Kevin Brancken and Fredrik Elmstrom battling it out. Two teammates, so you would think that they'd be working together between the two of them to see if they can push forward and get closed up to that Euphoria Racing white car. Is looking down the inside as the 272 car into turn one, and he's going to make that move. Well, he's not exactly being given that position, let's just say that, because Kevin Brancken didn't give him the room and didn't just drop behind him. He made him fight for that position.
Yeah, that also shows the respect that they do have for each other. Just because they're teammates doesn't mean that they're not allowed to race hard. Although one of the rule number ones in racing when it regards to your teammate is please do not take him out.
Absolutely, the team boss will have been on the old chat there just saying, come on boys, just think about this, think about the position in the race, because they are 5th and 6th in class. So they're going to get some good points here for the team. But you would think with that 272 car now of Fredrik Elmstrom, you would think that he would be now trying to just push forward and catch up to the 222 car, Juan Segarra, in the Euphoria Racing white car, because he's about the same pace as Juan. So could be interesting to see with 9 minutes 45 left in this race to see whether they can catch up that gap towards the end of that race.
Yeah, they should be able to catch it pretty much there. Yeah, they are closing by, so I do expect both Madcap Racing team cars work together to try to get that it'll be fourth and fifth place if they're able to go around Juan Segarra and the triple two Euphoria Racing white car.
Nicholas Helm has just exited the pits in that 191 car and exited in 11th place. So he was 6th place, now down to 11th. So that penalty has cost him quite a lot of places there, about 5 places there. So this battle's still going on. The two prototypes just going past the 272 car. Not both of them, but one of them is the Sim Racing for Holland car is up to the back of them as well. They're in third place. They're still battling it out with Team Heusinkveld. Team Heusinkveld, they're only 1.3 seconds behind. And, it's now down into the boot section of this track. Team Heusinkveld just trying to make that gap up. A little bit of smoke there as well, and that's definitely not good to see. But now coming into the heel of this track, and well, Euphoria Racing White, they are 1.4 seconds ahead of the 272 car. So that 272 car is slowly gaining place, gaining time on them, but I don't know whether it'll be enough given the time that's left in this race.
Yeah, they are getting pretty close by, but they should only around 7 minutes to go. They should have somewhere around 3 to 4 laps to get this done if they're gonna do it. So I think they should be able to take that fourth place from them, but let's see what happens.
Going through the S's there's quite a lot of traffic in this group here. Henry Gross is involved there, and the core sim racing 311 car is involved there as well, the GTC car. That's quite a gaggle of cars involved in that, but it's all just letting this gap just keep at a steady rate between that Euphoria Racing white car and the Mad Cape Racing Team, the 272 car.
Yeah, so far the 272 was able to clear all traffic now, so he should have the 222 in his sights now. So, and he's been running consistently faster laps throughout the last laps, although the last lap was a little bit slower, but that was because of traffic. So he should be able to now close the gap and perhaps overtake them.
We're going into the last 6 minutes of this race. Just five cars are on the lead lap. It's Blackadder Motorsports in the lead at the moment with Tommy van der Gucht at the wheel of that car. Second place, Juha Pakalame, in second for Core Sim Racing in that 111 car. Third place is Sim Racing for Holland. They've managed to make it through all the back markers that they were stuck behind, so able to pull away from Team Heusinkveld Engineering. In the GT3 class, Core Sim Racing, the 211 car, Mike Palach at the wheel of that car in the lead there by about 27.5 seconds over the second place car of NAB Racing. And you'd have to say, if it wasn't for that incident at the in the early part of this race, NAB Racing would have been right up there with Core.
Yeah, I do. And I do agree with you, but that's one of the unfortunate things of racing. You can kind of wonder on the what ifs, what if this happened, what if that happened, but you just gotta do what you gotta do. Whatever happened, just happened, and it is what it is. You race your race, and you gotta hope for the best.
And just to round out the top three in the GT3 class, it's Hulk Freak Racing, the 281 car with Stefan Koppens at the wheel. They are in third place in class. Just on the screen there, Friction Racing, they are together with Blue Flag Racing, the prototypes. This is over 7th and 8th place in this race. We're under 5 minutes now, and there's just 0.2 of a second between them, and Blue Flag Racing, they are looking down the inside. Darren Kirk just having to go on the defensive a little bit there from Matt Warmington. Matt Warmington just looking left, looking right, trying to make Darren Kirk make a mistake, and Kirk just looking for that later exit, apex, to try and get on the power earlier, but Matt Warmington now looking down the outside into the toe of the boot. Now that outside line not really going to work, but he's going to try and cut back now down the inside. He's going to look on the inside line for the heel of the boot. They're going to go down here. It's a slow left right hander late on the brakes there, giving each other room. Market Warmington just deciding against that, and just lost out a little bit of time there, just having to back off a little bit there. Just to let you know, in the GTC class quickly, that Baguette Racing are in the lead of that class, with Talk Freak Racing still in second place in that 381 car, and Core Sim Racing, the 311 car, are in third place and have dropped off a little bit from that Talk Freak Racing car. But it's this battle between Friction Racing and Blue Flag Racing that are battling away. And well, Mark Warmington down the inside and is head of Friction Racing.
Yeah, it looks like he made it easy for Darren Jones made it easy for the 155. Really not much of a battle there, but we also gotta consider that the 199 is, it's a little bit damaged from race contact very early in the race. So they've been doing a good job in keeping the car on the racetrack. It's been really unfortunate the bad luck that they had through the series so far. But also major kudos for them for not letting those incidents let them down. And you know, because it can be kind of demoralizing that you prepare so long for races like this, and one small thing can really throw the whole race out. And so, major kudos for them for keeping their minds on the track and never giving up as well.
So we're coming up to the 2-minute warning in this race, And, well, it's still Blackadder Motorsports in the lead of this one. They've done a very good job there. From the front, they have led just over half of this race. Fallen there, 55 laps that they've led in this race. Corsim Racing, of course, were in the lead for quite a while. 43 laps in this race and they were battling away. And now Euphoria Racing White, they have got Madcape Racing, the 272. We said they might catch them up, and well, they have done, because there's less than half a second between the two now, and this is a battle for fourth place in GT3.
Yeah, it seems like time running out, and now the Madcape Racing is just turning up the aggressiveness level, and they're going through one of the GTC classes, GTC cars as well. So yeah, really close racing so far. Only 1 minute to go, so they should have one more lap now. So let's see if Madcape Racing can complete the pass and take fourth place.
Yeah, that blue line Motorsports car really didn't want to get in the way of these two that are battling it out for position. They just want to finish this race now. But yeah, this is a battle. It's going to go down to the wire and, well, into the heel of the boot. And it's now just 0.3 of a second between these two. So it's one Juan Segarra, and down the inside, looking down the inside there. That's an ambitious move over the curbs there, because they're quite high curbs. But Madcape Racing with Fredrik Elmstrom, well, he's getting impatient. He wants to make this move and make it now, but still behind for the time being, behind that Euphoria Racing white car. Coming out the final corner, will they get the better run? They're going to get the draft down the pit straight, and well, defensive straight away is Euphoria Racing white. They're looking at keeping the inside line, and Madcape Racing just have to hold on for the time being, but they should get the better exit out of there, and through the S's they should have the run up over the top of the hill into that chicane.
Yeah, definitely good racing for both of them. Now the Madcape, he should be in the draft, but looks like he's too far away to complete the pass going into the bus stop, so we should have them racing for one more lap.
And well, the leader is coming across the line, Blackadder Motorsports, with Tommy van der Gucht at the wheel across the line to win this race. A fantastic effort from them there to win this race from the front, pretty much from the front in the second half of this race. Corsim Racing, they're just coming round into the final corner now. They're going to take the second place overall in this race. I'm keeping an eye on this battle between those two GT3 classic cars as well. And Corsim Racing, the 211 car, is coming across the line. They're going to win the GT3 class. So that's a good result for them. But this battle between Euphoria Racing White and Madcape Racing, it's going to go to the death. It's absolutely desperate from the 272 of the Madcape Racing team. Looking left, looking right, trying to make them go through. Down the inside they go now, side by side through the left-hander. Maybe made a little bit of contact there, but they're going to have the inside going into this left-hander now, the penultimate corner, but round the outside goes Euphoria Racing White. Fantastic bravery there from Juan Segarra into the final corner now. Will they be able to make the move going across the line? It's going to be close, but I think it's going to be the Euphoria Racing White car across the line to take that fourth place in class. Fantastic effort from them there to keep that Madcape Racing team 272 car behind them. Just having a look for Baguette Racing. Baguette Racing, they're coming up to the penultimate corner now to finish that race. And well, it's been a masterclass once again from the front. Javier Meliard keeping that first place down the inside into that final corner now. And well, it runs over the curb, gets a little bit of grass, but right up to the pit wall, and they're going to take the win. In fact, going down the pit wall in taking the win for that GTC class. And wow, that was fantastic. That was breathless. We're going to go through the results in a second, but Alvin, just quickly, that was a close race right to the end there for those GT3 cars.
Yeah, definitely. They tried to my hats to the 222 car, keeping that fourth place and really battling for it. They really earned that spot today, and congratulations to all the winners as well.
So we'll just go through the results of this race, and what a race it has been. Blackadder Motorsports, the 166 car, they led the race for 57 laps, and they end up winning this race by 20.6 seconds. Over Core Sim Racing, the 111 car, they finished second place. Sim Racing for Holland, number 13 seconds behind, finished in third place. Team Horsenvelt Engineering, it's good points for their championship. They finished fourth. Pros Racing Sport finishing in fifth. That was the last of the cars on the lead lap. Legends Racing, they finished sixth place in that prototype class. Blue Flag Racing prototype in seventh, with FRT Hawkers, the 140 car, finishing in eighth. Friction Racing in ninth, and the Apex Racing Team in 10th place, with a couple more drivers teams finishing in that prototype class. In the GT3s, I can tell you that it was Core Sim Racing, the 211 car, that finished first place in that class. Second place was NAB Racing, who had that incident earlier on in the race, but able to finish second, so well done to them. Third place, Torque Creek Racing, did a fantastic job in that race, with Euphoria Racing White, as we saw, across the line, finishing fourth, with Mad Cape Racing in fifth place. In the GTC class, it was, as we say, a dominant display once again by Baguette Racing to win that race. Second place was Torque Freak Racing in the 381 car, did a fantastic job to hold off the Core Sim Racing car partway through that race, who finished third in the 311 car. Orange Devils in fourth, with Blue Line Motorsports in fifth place, with Darren Barrowclough. And that was breathless. That was fantastic and thoroughly enjoyable to commentate on. Alvin, just your thoughts. Who would you say was the team of the race today?
Well, so far, team of the race had to be Baguette Racing. Another masterful race from them. Dominant race from start to finish. Really, nobody can touch them today.
Absolutely, they did a fantastic performance. And well, we're joined now by the race winning driver of Christian Challoner from Blackadder Motorsports, the 166 car. And well, congratulations, Christian, a fantastic performance from your team. You must be delighted with the win.
Thanks. It was pretty tricky, especially at the start there, because I wasn't really expecting a standing start, so that kind of caught me out. But I think once we got through all that, we knew we had a really good car, so we were just trying to get ourselves back at the front. And then Tommy did a great job taking over and sort of pulled us away there.
You're not the other ones that got caught out by that sandy start. We did as well. But you know, as we say, we were saying on the commentary, you led basically the second half of that race. Just talk us through that race from your point of view as a team. Was it the strategy that won you, or was it just the case of the pace of both yourself and also your teammate, Tommy Vandergoch, to be able to take that win?
I think, if I'm honest, it was probably a bit of both. We knew that we probably had either the quickest or the second quickest car out there, because the friction car was really, really fast. So we were worried they were gonna pull away when they got ahead there. But then we were a little bit confused, actually, as to what everyone was doing on strategy, because we reasoned that the best way to do the race was to split it into 45-minute segments. And so when we saw people keep going, we decided, okay, well, we'll stick to what we're gonna do, because we thought it'd work, and we'd already planned the fuel around that. And it just worked out. I mean, the start and the first stint probably could have gone a little bit better. It was a bit close fought, but no, it was a lot of fun.
And your team last time out at Circuit of the Americas didn't have the best result, so to come back here and to win this race, be the first team other than Team Horsenvelt Engineering to win overall, it must do wonders for your championship.
I know we had a bit of a tough time at COTA, and I think a lot of that came down to the fact that it's pretty much none of our favourite tracks, and also the other two guys, Brandon and Tommy, both play on single screens, so I know it's really difficult for those guys to see the apexes there, and it does cost you a lot of time. But we had a pretty good showing at Sebring, so we knew that if we got it together, we could actually pull off a good performance. And Tommy's been quick here all week, so has Brandon. And yeah, we knew that we were going to have a good shot at it.
And just looking at next round, we go to the circuit Spa-Francorchamps for the next round. Is that a circuit that you particularly enjoy as a team? That you think? Do you think you'll be able to go well there?
Yeah, we've had pretty good success at Spa in the past. I know the other guys actually Tommy and John who won the AEC Spa 24 Hours in a BMW. So those guys run well there. I personally don't really like Spa that much, just because I'm not really a great fan of how the off-track system works there. But in terms of pace, I think we should be able to do a pretty good job again.
Okay, and just finally, anyone that you want to give a quick mention to while you're on here?
There's probably too many guys to give a shout out to, really, but our sponsor, GP Racing Karts, I'd like to give them a shout out, and Nenad for sorting us all the paints and everything that we have.
Okay, well, thanks a lot for joining us there, Christian, and well done on the win there.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
Okay, and joining us with Hugo is Evan Milliard from Baguette Racing.
Evan, 3-4-3, another dominating performance. It seems like the only thing that may scare you from title time is sometimes when you're going through traffic.
Yeah, well, yeah, especially at this track, really. But yeah, it was another very good race again. And we had a lot of fun doing it.
Yeah, another dominating performance by both of you. Now you're going to Spa-Francorchamps, a favorite track for, I'll say, most of the drivers. I guess you will be expecting nothing less than another race win.
Well, we'll try to go for that, and yeah, hopefully it's going to work. I really love Spa. It's a great track, so yeah, it's going to be fun.
Yeah, absolutely. Is there anybody else that you would like to thank?
Well, as ever, I want to thank Yassin for his driving, because he's doing very good. He's a great teammate. I want to thank you guys again for the broadcast and the tournament. It's very good. And yeah, well, that's pretty much it.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, that was Evian Maliard from the Baguette Racing team there. And what we're going to do is we're going to have a quick word with a driver who was involved in a little bit of an incident in the race there. And that's Fabien de Jong with the NAB Racing team. And, well, we saw you finish second there, but do you think that incident early on in the race just scuppered any chances of you going for the win?
Yeah, I think so. It's going to be close, but I think because of the incident in the chicane, I lost, I think, about 15 seconds or so. And, yeah, because of the incident, I also lost some pace and etc. And of course I needed to fix the damage in the first pit stop, so yeah, maybe we could have won it, but yeah. Also Simon did the last stint and his pace is a little bit slower, but yeah, we never know.
Absolutely, you never know, but a good drive from you, from your team, to be able to battle through. And looking at the championship, you know, you should be happy to finish second, because you were at the top of that championship in Racing Lions. They finished, what, about eighth place in class, so you've been able to pull out the gap on them.
Yeah, only Core did gain a little bit, but I think it's only a few points, so yeah. Nothing to worry about at this moment, but actually we didn't know even was P2 was possible, but yeah. You were surprised.
And just finally, anyone you want to give a quick mention to from yourselves?
My teammates, and of course Simon, who's also waiting for the interview for the last stint. He did an amazing job.
Okay, well, thanks a lot for your comments there, and well done on the second place there, Fabio.
Yeah, thank you.
And Alvin, who have you got with you there?
Yeah, we got David Baraklov from Tour Freak Racing. David, that second place, at one point in the race, you had a hard battle with the Core Sim Racing GTC car. Tell us how that battle went through before it got disrupted by contact with lap traffic.
Yeah, that was a really, really crazy race. We were just trying to stay out of trouble. There were a couple of really large incidents which we just managed to avoid. Got to the last stint. I jumped back in the car after, and Sasha did a really solid second stint. We were roughly 20 seconds down from core and kind of settling in for the P3, and then they came back towards us. Came out something around. They came out half a second behind because I just managed to dive through at the penultimate corner after they had their incident. I think they must have spun just coming back onto the NASCAR track. Just managed to sneak through, and that was really key because I was able to kind of pull out everything I had to keep them behind, and I'll tell you, they were going so quick and it was so difficult, but somehow I managed it. When that moment happened between the BMW and the C-Spec behind, I don't know, it was a tricky one because I didn't want to let the BMW through the bus stop, so I didn't move slightly towards the middle of the track. We weren't side by side or anything like that, so the BMW had to wait. But unfortunately, Core didn't realize quite what was happening. They kind of counted that out. They unfortunately made contact. It's a shame, really, because it was a really fun battle. But we're really happy with second place, of course.
Yeah, we were definitely having fun by watching you guys battle as well. Is there anybody else you want to thank?
Yeah, I just like to thank my teammate, really. He did a really great job, took over the car, kept it nice and clean, kept us in the race, put us in a position to get the podium, really. I'd also like to thank the rest of Team Talk Freak, the guys in the other car, and all members of the team, really, for making the team such a great, fun place to drive, really.
All right, thank you very much. That was David Baraklov for Torque Freak Racing.
And from one Torque Freak Racing driver to another Torque Freak Racing driver, it's Bram Renners. And, third place in the end there for your team. You must be happy with that result. Of course, gaining positions during the race as well.
We didn't expect it. To be honest, the strength is very high. Strength is very high in this competition, so we didn't expect it, but it's very nice.
And just talk us through your race, because as you say, you finished third in that race. Were you happy with your pace? Were you able to compete with the cars around you in that race?
We were the first stint, Stefan did that one. We were just hanging back. I think Stefan was able to overtake somebody, was faster than the guy in front of him, but we just waited to see what was happening. I did a good lap. We didn't gain any positions the first stint, but we made it safe. And I did the second stint then. My pace could have been a little bit faster, but safety first for me.
Absolutely, it gets you some good points there for the team, because you've not had the best first two rounds, so you must be delighted to just get a big points haul this race.
Yeah, I don't remember exactly the first race, but Gotha was very bad for us. We didn't finish it, so.
And just finally, anyone that you want to thank for this race?
Of course, the team and Stefan especially, and of course the organization as well. That's about it.
Well, congratulations. Well done on the third place there, and best of luck for Spa next time out.
Thank you. See you next race.
Yes, that's Bram Reniers there for the Talk Freak Racing car, who finished the 281 car, that finished third place in GT3. And, well, Alvin, It's been great having you back with us on the commentary. Thanks a lot for joining us this time. And just your final thoughts on this race, really, because it's been, once again, an exciting race in this championship.
Yeah, well, first of all, thanks to you and Hugo for letting me help you guys and the race broadcast. As always, it's really nice to being able to help you, and also appreciate another part of sim racing that some people may not appreciate. It's really harder than what it looks. I can tell you that. And race-wise, it's definitely another great race. Good action all over the track, and yeah, pretty much everybody definitely did a fantastic job on the racetrack.
And well, we'll go to Spa-Francorchamps next time out, and that's a really tough track. And as they were saying, there's plenty of scope of picking up the instant points, and it's definitely a tough track, but it's another classic of the endurance racing circuits.
Yeah, definitely next round on Spa, even though there may be some teams will be racking up the incident points, it's one of those tracks that everybody enjoys. I really haven't seen anybody that doesn't enjoy running in Spa, so I know that next round, which should be coming next year, as a matter of fact, everybody should be having a smile in their faces while pretty much tackling all those classic corners through Spa-Francorchamps.
Well, this has been an absolute pleasure once again to bring you the Gathering of Tweakers Endurance Series, the 3 hours of Watkins Glen. Just like to thank Anwen Designs for the graphics, Istvan Balo for the cameras once again, to Alvin Nieves for joining me on commentary, and for Hugo Louis operating those cameras. It's been an absolute pleasure to bring it to you on iRacing Live. Of course, this has been a production of RaceSpot TV. I've been Paul Smith, and from everyone here at RaceSpot, we would like to wish you all a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Take care and good night.